to sing the Canadian anthem, a chorus from Quebec City directed by Guy Bélanger.
Le chœur de Rendez-vous 87, dirigé par Monsieur Guy Bélanger, interprétera maintenant le Haut-Canada.
Official face-off of this one-time event, we ask you to welcome three of the greatest hockey players ever.
Pour faire la mise au jeu officielle de cette série tout à fait unique, nous invitons maintenant trois des plus grands joueurs de l'histoire de notre sport national. Tous trois ont marqué leur époque et écrit dans leur pays respectif les plus belles pages de l'histoire de notre sport national au Canada, aux États-Unis et en Union soviétique.
They are part of the hockey legend in the Soviet Union, the United States, and Canada. Ladies and gentlemen, mesdames et messieurs, let's greet Vladislav Tretiak, Gordie Howe, and Jean Béliveau.
Nous demandons maintenant aux capitaines des deux équipes, Vyacheslav Fetisov et Wayne Gretzky, de s'approcher au centre de la patinoire pour la mise au jeu protocolaire.
As goes the tradition in international competition, the captains exchange their respective emblems.
Comme le veut la tradition, les capitaines des deux équipes s'échangent maintenant les emblèmes officiels des deux formations.
From an international site, the ceremonial face-off. We are just about ready for the face-off, game one of Rendezvous 87. The NHL All-Stars against the Soviet Union, coming up. This is the time when everyone, no matter from what country, attempts to get rid of the butterflies. I think they exist not only on the ice, in the stands, I know they exist in the booth, and Bill Clement, I imagine for this worldwide television audience, there's some butterflies in a lot of living rooms around the world.
I think there are, Ken. I have picked up the scent, I have started to taste, and I'm sure I'm very much like the players. I'm ready to eat now.
The main course is ready to unfold, first of two between the NHL All-Stars and the Soviet national team. There is the referee. Tonight from the Soviet Union, Nikolai Morozov. And from the NHL, as will be the case again on Friday night, veteran NHL linesman John DiMico and Ron Finn. By the way, on Friday night, we'll see a National Hockey League referee. In goal, the youngster, only 20 years of age, Evgeny Belosheikin.
Belosheikin, Ken, is without a doubt their number one man. He has patterned his style, as the Soviets have asked him to do, after the great Tretiak, who's involved in our opening ceremony tonight. He has a tendency at times to be inconsistent. I think all of the people on our side are hoping that he picks one of these times to be inconsistent. At the other end, our coaching staff has elected to play Grant Fuhr of the Edmonton Oilers, who had a back injury until three games ago, came back, performed well. We saw him last Sunday night in Edmonton. He is very, very sharp. I think we both agree, Ken. Very nice selection for our goaltending. And there is Viktor Tikhonov, the head coach of the Soviet Union. 10 years he has coached in the Soviet Union. He played for the Dynamo team out of Moscow for 10 years as a defenseman. Amazing. Even over there, ex-defensemen become coaches, Ken.
And co-coach from the Montreal Canadiens, Jean Perron, working with Quebec coach Michel Bergeron on the bench. Bob Johnson, another co-coach from the Calgary Flames, is upstairs tonight. He'll be behind the bench with Jean Perron for the final game here on Friday night.
That's a lot of head coaching. It's only proper that they put them in rotation. They're all being very cooperative. We've talked to them. They're not reluctant at all to get together in a group and discuss things with us, and we're thankful to their cooperation. Not only cooperating with one another, but they've been very helpful to us as well.
There are so many keys, as Bill Clement pointed out just at the beginning of our telecast. Keys for the NHL All-Stars to win. Keys in terms of the Soviet team in their effort to win. And I guess one of the keys you mentioned, the third item on our list on the Soviet side, officiating, could be a big swing, especially in game one.
Well, the last time Nikolai Morozov officiated a game against the National Hockey League team, there he is. It was in Minnesota. He called 28 minutes in penalties, Ken, 24 against the Minnesota North Stars. He also skates with the Soviet team, travels with them, and is buddies with most of the people. We hope in the early going, because we are going to try and clutch, grab, slow them down, and you know that there's a ton of adrenaline on our side. We're going to hope that it doesn't get one-sided early.
As far as the NHL All-Stars are concerned, they'll start Mario Lemieux between Michel Goulet and Claude Lemieux for the Soviet team. It's that big veteran fivesome. Larionov at center, Krukov and Makarov on the wings, and Fedosov and Kasatonov are the defensemen. On defense for the NHL All-Stars, Langway with the puck, team with Samuelson. Here's Makarov against Goulet. Then Lemieux gets the puck and banks it down the ice. There'll be no icing as it went off the glove of Vyacheslav Fedosov. Now, the NHL All-Stars centering Claude Lemieux, and it's intercepted. Here comes Sergei Makarov, the 28-year-old Soviet winger, over the line with Larionov, and it's intercepted. A chance for the NHL to clear the zone, but quickly Krutov, and he whips the puck back in as Fuhr leaves it for Ulf Samuelson, the Swede from Hartford. Claude Lemieux, the Montreal Canadiens second-year player, gets the puck up, and it's shot out by the Penguins' Mario Lemieux. This is Tatarinov, number six for the Soviet Union, getting the puck to center ice. It's lost there, and it's Sergei Makarov again. He can score. He overskates. Dave Poulin of the Flyers clears the zone. Mikhail Tatarinov, number six. Now with the puck, it's Pervukin, number five for the Soviet Union, getting it in, and here's Poulin, one of the best defensive players in this game. Getting the puck to Howardchuk, and he deflects it to center ice. Barnikov for the Soviet Union. Off the boards to Semenov. He's the centerman. Now the right winger, Svetlov. Sergei Svetlov. He's number 16. He's yanked down. No call. Ramsey knocked off balance. Then Howardchuk backhands the puck in as the NHL All-Stars change on the fly. A minute and a half gone in the first period. No score.
And we have to be careful of tempo. We talked about the Russians playing a very fast speed. We could use more whistles than they could.
Here's Ray Bourque, and his shot goes wide. The centering effort and trying to turn it in front was Glenn Anderson. Anderson behind the net. In front to Sandstrom, and the shot goes wide. And the Soviets clear the zone. Messier had a good chance in front with Sandstrom. Best opportunity to score for either side belongs to the NHL. 2:10 has gone by in the first period. Tomas Sandstrom playing with injured ribs. The New York Ranger not expected to go. Now Anderson trying to get the puck in, and the Soviets gain possession. Soviets have very long shift compared to the NHL All-Stars. Valery Kaminsky shoots the puck wide. It's played away from Komatov. And Chris Chelios, one of the American-born NHL All-Stars, clears the zone. And back for the puck is Chris Chelios, who really calls San Diego, California home. Out on the wing it comes. An opportunity for Tikkanen. It's Tikkanen with Gretzky and Curry. This is the all-Edmonton Oilers line for the NHL All-Stars. Curry in front. He turns it wide. Gretzky a shot and a good save by Belosheikin. This is Rendezvous 87. Early in the first period, there's no score. Boy, our Edmonton Oilers line of Wayne Gretzky with Tikkanen and Curry came so close here. Curry had the best chance before this. Ken Gretzky tried a sharp angle shot. Belosheikin smartly covering up. Now the faceoff near the Soviet goal. The NHL All-Stars, Bill, to a man, feel the first 10 minutes are so essential, setting really the entire stage for this two-game series.
I think so, Ken. With the adrenaline that has been building, with the youth, we have a number of players that have never faced the Soviets. That combined with the potential scary statistics of the official makes the first 10 minutes very important to stabilize and become cohesive as a unit.
A so-called checking line on for the NHL All-Stars. Howard, Chuck, Poulin, and Denis against the Big Five from the Red Army, the KLM line. Makarov getting the puck in front. The play broken up. Now trying to get it out, and doing it is Rick Green. Ahead to Poulin. And a good poke check to steer it away by Krutov of the Soviet Union. Some heavy activity deep in the Soviet zone, and here come the Soviets. Larionov feeds on the wing too far for Makarov. Here's Rod Langway, University of New Hampshire product, grew up in the Boston area. Out to Kirk Muller from the New Jersey Devils, and his pass is broken up at the defense by Kasatonov. Krutov, the 26-year-old winger, prolific scorer for the U.S.S.R. This is typical. They'll slow things down, wind it up, try to get the good chance. The Soviets really don't shoot the puck in or dump it in that often. It's the Soviet Union on the attack, and Smetlov knocked off the puck. Sandstrom can't clear it out. Now the NHL All-Stars get the puck to center ice. An opportunity for Glenn Anderson. On with Sandstrom. Bork shoots the puck in. A delayed offside. NHL All-Stars have not cleared the zone, but the puck does. It's the Soviet Union. Barnikov gets the puck off on the right side, and Semenov spun around by Doug Wilson of the Blackhawks. The NHL. Bork driving it in, and the save by Belosheikin. And the puck shot down the ice. There'll be no icing. Back to play. It is Buffalo's Mike Ramsey. Here's Mark Messier. He's stopped in the neutral zone by Tatarinov. And the NHL just clears the puck through center ice. Back to play it. Igor Stelnov, who celebrates his 24th birthday tomorrow. He clears the center ice. Samuelson to Gretzky. To Tikkanen. He spins away from a check. And Tikkanen behind the net, battling for the puck, and the Soviet Union gains possession. Clearing the zone is Stelnov, and the pass goes too far for Kaminsky. Fuhr leaving it for Ramsey. Play relatively cautious at the 5:10 mark of the first period with no score here in game one from Quebec City. Ari Curry, one of the two Finns, steals the puck. Over to Tikkanen, the other Finn. The two Finns, Tikkanen and Curry, playing with Gretzky in the middle, and Curry shoots scores! Ari Curry, and it's 1-0 NHL All-Stars.
Ken, before the game, Bobby Clark, general manager of the Philadelphia Flyers, said it was a good idea for us to put lines out there to select guys that have played together before. Gretzky knows where Curry is at all times. See him do his little stop. Yari Curry's always in that spot, sifting through the slot. He caught it all. This is a reverse angle look at it. Gretzky will give it the big stop with number 27, Bykov, going to check him. Curry just one times it right between Belosheikin's leg. There's a screen off to his right, but I really don't think it was a factor. Curry caught it all right between his legs.
1-0. The NHL All-Stars take the lead. From the faceoff, the Soviet Union shooting the puck in. Here's Langway. To Mario Lemieux. It is Lemieux with Claude Lemieux and Michel Goulet, the French-Canadian line. That play is broken up, and a chance now for the Soviet team. As Samak shoots the puck in, backboard is Rick Green, the defenseman from Montreal. He's teamed on defense with Langwood. Green, the oldest NHL All-Star. 5:23, the time of the goal. Curry from Gretzky and Tikkanen. Here's Goulet after the puck. He's checked on the play. And the Soviets come to center ice with Kreyakin. Getting the puck in the middle. Now over to Samak, and his shot deflects off Chelios into the crowd. We're at the Coliseum in Quebec. 1-0 NHL.
One thing Wayne Gretzky does better than anyone is change directions. He does this. Look at three Soviets in front. Nobody is high enough in that slot to take Yari Curry. We talked about them breaking down, Ken. They can be had defensively if you maintain possession in their end long enough. That was an indication of it right there. Three men were in a little deep. Curry coming into the deep spot, winding up and one-timing it.
And you go back to your three key points for the Soviets in order to defeat the NHL. Neutralize Gretzky and Mario Lemieux.
Well, he was in gear there, wasn't he?
Buck goes right on goal. Evgeny Belosheikin, the 20-year-old netminder, making the save. Fedosov gets it up to Krutov. He's stopped, but the Soviet Union gets the puck back as Kasatonov feeds on the wing to Makarov. Back to Kasatonov. He's got Krutov in front, goes to the point. Here's Fedosov, and that shot's blocked, and the puck kangaroos into the crowd. And there, Bill Clement, you can start to see a little of that nifty passing from Makarov, Larionov, Krutov, Fedosov, and Kasatonov.
Now, there's no question they can dazzle, but number 14, Kevin Dineen of the Hartford Whalers, watch him get down on front of this shot. He had help from Dave Poulin. Two gutsy, great two-way hockey players as we look at it from our reverse angle. The Soviets for years did never try and blast from the point. They are shooting from the point a lot more, but our two blockers, Poulin and Kevin Dineen, that's one of the reasons they were selected, and they will play against some of the top offensive people on the Soviet team, and they are out there against their number one unit now.
Our Chuck, Poulin and Dineen trying to stop Makarov, Larionov, and Krutov for the men in right. The men in red from the Soviet national team. It is already 1-0 NHL All-Stars on an early first period goal by the Edmonton Oilers' Yari Curry. Alf Samuelson clears the zone with the puck, Kasatonov. He's a playmaker for the USSR. Now it's Anderson for the NHL as the NHL attempts to change lines. Larionov, the centerman on this big Red Army contingent. He gets the puck in and... back goes the NHL, Messier to Anderson. They're on a line with Sandstrom of the Rangers, who goes for the puck and gets there first. Thus, no icing. Anderson in front, and Messier's pass fails to reach him. And Messier stops. An opportunity for Semenov. His pass broken up. Anderson on a feed from Messier over the line. Messier, a real battler, can't get the puck from Anderson, and it's cleared out. What a check there. Barnikov down in a heap as the NHL controls, and Messier's pass to an open wing. Tatarinov, a 20-year-old on defense for the USSR, up the middle to Mikhail Barnikov. He drops the puck, and Svechkov's shot is right there, and Fuhr has to be alert on that effort. This is the NHL All-Stars against the Soviet Union.
You know, our coaches, the NHL coaches, maintain that this game can be won or lost in the neutral zone. Here's Rod Langway leveling number 19 of the Soviet Union, Mikhail Varnikov. Then he moves over and takes Svetlov out of the play. That is the kind of determined play we need in the neutral zone. From the reverse angle, here's Grant Fuhr's save on Svetlov's shot. End over ender. Boy, that came close, didn't it? The bouncing between his legs.
When you see that exclusive slow motion reverse angle shot, you realize what a tricky shot that actually was. NHL All-Stars clearing the puck from the faceoff. Back for it, Sergei Starikov. He's on defense with Igor Stelnov for the USSR. On the wing, Bikov, he's number 27. Trying to get the puck to Kaminsky, he's turned around. The other wing is Komutov for the USSR. He has the puck, Komutov to Bikov. Bikov looking for Kaminsky, and he drills the shot wide. Keeping it in is Stelnov. Kaminsky checked behind the net. Doug Wilson gets the puck to Tikkanen. Back to Doug Wilson. He can't clear it out, but finally the puck to center ice, and Curry just out of the reach with a pass intended for Gretzky. Centering effort, and a Tikkanen shot goes high. Here's Mike Ramsey. Behind the net to Gretzky. He's got Curry in front. Samuelson in the shot. Slot with a shot that's blocked. Oh, did Alf Samuelson let one go? Komutov gets the puck up the middle, a bruising check on Bikov. An opportunity here. Homyatov, a shot blocked, and it's Esatikin in the fin playing with the Oilers. On a line now with Mario Lemieux as the NHLers are changing players. And a strong defensive play by Gusarov. NHL shoots the puck right back in. This is Alexei Gusarov, a 22-year-old defenseman. Krihakin, who's on with Samak and Hamiloff. Samak, a shot, and Fuhr just gets a little leather on that one as he had the far post picked out. Jari Kurri has a goal. The NHL All-Stars 1 and the Soviet Union 0. Indoors at the Coliseum, part of Winter Carnival 87. It's Rendezvous 87. The Soviet Union trailing 1-0 with the puck. The NHL All-Stars, the best pro players from Canada, the U.S., Sweden, and Finland. Grant Fuhr playing the puck to Claude Lemieux. Gusarov is all over him. Rick Green covers up. Gerard Langway, he's in trouble. Hamiloff on him, and the Soviet Union doing some good forechecking. Krihakin loses the puck. It's played on the wing for Michel Goulet. He's trying to get around Belosheikin and can. At center ice, Chris Chelios. There's Goulet, a drive right on, and the rebound effort. And unable to beat Belosheikin is Ray Bourque. Back the other way. Krihakin, he's decked, and there'll be a penalty, the first penalty of the night, as the Soviet Sergei Krihakin was yanked down. We'll see the Soviet power play. They trail 1-0.
The Soviet goalie, Evgeny Belosheikin, can make the save. He recovers very, very quickly from the original. He was going down to make that save. As soon as he left the rebound, he was back up in position. That is one thing he does very, very well, especially for a 20-year-old. Here's our reverse angle look at it. Goulet winds up, takes the blast. He's going down to save it. Right back up on his feet, in position. Perfect position to face Ray Bourque, who really had a sharp angle, Ken, from there.
And we hope you enjoy that slow motion look here on ESPN, that reverse angle. Hooking penalty, 2-minute minor at 10:30 of the first period. Claude Lemieux, the Montreal Canadiens, goes off. We'll see the Soviet Union power play. Messier killing the penalty. Going one-on-one with Kasatonov, gets a shot, and Belosheikin makes the save. Here's Vyacheslav Fetisov. He's number two to Vladimir Krukov. And a shot goes wide by Kasatonov. Here's Makarov for the USSR. They have the man advantage. Larionov, Makarov, Krutov is out in the slot. It's 1-0 NHL. And Fetisov can't accept the pass. As the action continues and Poulin is stopped, Budweiser keeps the action going here in game one of Rendezvous 87. Enjoy the game and enjoy a cold Bud for all you do. This Bud's for you.
And there are a number of captains representing their teams. Dave Poulin is one. Was I happy when he was selected? You know, we sat back like everyone else and examined the selections and said, well, who do we like? Who do we not like? I was as happy with this team as any team I've ever seen selected. And Dave Poulin, with his work ethic, his speed, and his defensive ability, say nothing of his leadership qualities, really a nice addition to this team.
Wayne Gretzky killing the penalty. Jari Kurri up front. The Edmonton Oilers in the regular season lead the NHL in shorthanded goals, much in thanks to the work of Gretzky and Kurri. On defense, Samuelson anchoring the right side and Mike Ramsey on the left side. He looks up and sees Vladimir Krutov. Krutov turns in the corner, plays the puck around the boards to Makarov. Power play, Soviet Union. NHL leads 1-0 first period. Fetisov over to Makarov. The puck deflected high. Samuelson unable to steer it away. Kasatonov, a pass in front. Makarov to Fetisov. Fetisov looking. Look how the Soviets pass that puck. Makarov. Larionov in front to Makarov, and he's tied up. Now Krutov handling it. And Kasatonov watches Kurri clear the zone, and it's Gretzky with Fetisov back. Two of the all-time greats, and Vyacheslav Fetisov is able to block that shot by Gretzky.
Ken, the only time that Gretzky and Curry are going to get in trouble killing penalties is in our own zone. They play very well offensively. They can score a lot of shorthanded goals. But I'll tell you, that KLM line, the green unit of the Soviets, can turn even the best defensive players inside out. And they are not known for their defensive work, so they have to stay out of our own end.
Puck at the side of the net. Fuhr pokes it away, and Rick Green is after it. He's the oldest NHL player as he goes down. And the puck covered. We have a stoppage in play with 7:29 to go in the first period. And Claude Lemieux, the penalized player, is back on. And the NHL, certainly Bill Clement, saw some fancy Soviet passing on that power play.
Their skills are wonderful, Ken, and there's a very good reason for it. They have excellent, excellent coaching from a very young age. They come up through a hockey system. We'll take a look at it here. Look at Makarov dipsy-doodling through. He was dragged down on the way by. When he went by, then he even passed it over when he was lying down. But their manual skills combined with their skating are really, really excellent. Here's a look at our reverse angle. Wayne Gretzky coming down, electing to shoot. Fedosov is perfect timing. You notice how he didn't go and charge Wayne Gretzky. He stayed back. He let his stick make the deflection. If Wayne went stopped and tried to come back, he had him. They are aware that Wayne Gretzky loves that stop move, cutback move.
Jari Kurri has the only goal of this first period as the NHL All-Stars are called for icing. Kurri from Gretzky and Tikkanen at 5:23 here in the first period. There is Kirk Muller, one of the youngest players. He's only 21 years of age.
Why was he happy to be here? He was so excited, and he said yesterday, I don't know if I'm more nervous about playing against the Soviet Union or playing with the guys on this team. When I look around the room and see Wayne Gretzky and Mario Lemieux, it's unnerving at times, but they got a couple of practices under their belts, and he looks rather comfortable out there. He is a nice addition as well, Ken. Excellent skater, great skills, and a very, very durable, rough hockey player when he wants to.
Both teams are at full strength. NHL All-Stars leading 1-0. Bork to Chelios. Up the middle, and on the middle play, the puck is Howardchuk, centering Dineen and Poulin. Bill Clement saying that the NHL had to neutralize the Soviet speed, forecheck well, and eliminate quality shots. He'll be talking about their success or lack of it during the first intermission with Tom Mies. In front, Dineen goes barreling into the crossbar as he's checked by Pervukin. That stops play, and surviving the collision is the young Soviet goaltender, Evgeny Belosheikin.
Well, I'm really not surprised to see this kind of determination from Kevin Dineen. He basically takes everyone out. He knew at that stage that he would never get a stick on the puck. What do? Make up your mind to clear the whole area. Takes the defenseman into the net. Reverse angle, we'll see him coming from the top right of our screen. Howardchuk basically just lays it in front, hoping someone can get to it. Dineen just throws her into charge gear. Takes everybody, including the net.
Well, Bill, you had three key points for the Soviets in order for them to be successful. One was Evgeny Belosheikin. He's given up the one goal. He had to have a good game. You wanted to really watch the Soviets, see if they could neutralize Gretzky and Mario Lemieux. And the other question, of course, was the officiating. And we certainly haven't had any problem. And the NHL was worried, especially early in the game, with the Soviet official who is the referee tonight.
No, we have actually, as usual, taken the physical play to the Soviet Union. He has called one penalty. Thus far, I would say he's calling a very impartial period.
Again, during the first intermission, one of the highlights will be Bill visiting with Tom Mies and going over the checklist of key points for both the NHL and the Soviet Union. That's during our first intermission, which I believe you're going to find very entertaining. There's 6:20 to go in the first period, 1-0 NHL All-Stars. Soviet Union coming to center ice. Komatov with a puck. He's number 15, crunched to the boards by Claude Lemieux. And Kaminsky, the 20-year-old Valerie Kaminsky, number 13 over the line. His wrist shot goes wide. Bykov with a puck to Kaminsky. Komatov looking. Kaminsky in front. Oh, Fuhr makes a dandy save on Andrei Komatov, the 25-year-old Soviet sharpshooter.
He had all kinds of time, Ken. The front of the net cleared out to the wrong side. Grant Fuhr came out and follows him so well. It was Lemieux that missed the check on him. Komatov, or it's Kaminsky, has time to come way out. Notice how Fuhr read the shot. Kaminsky had room to Grant Fuhr's right side, up over his right shoulder. We'll see it again from this side, and it won't really show us how much room he has, but Fuhr plays the angle of the stick. He left him that room over his right shoulder, knowing where he was going to shoot, and Fuhr reads the shooters very well, as does Belosheikin. I think Belosheikin reads them as well as anybody in the world today. He can tell the difference between a pass and a shot, and he can read where the shot's going so well.
Chomansky doing a good job wrapping around as Homyatov really was bottled up by the two defensemen and Bykov. So this line of Homyatov, Chomansky, and Bykov for the Soviet Union buzzing around Grant Fuhr as the Soviets attempt to tie this game. It is 1-0 NHL. Rick Green played with Washington, and he's really blossomed a little later in his career with Montreal.
He's actually involved in this game with the man that was the key going the other way in the trade that sent him from Washington to Montreal, Rod Langway. As a matter of fact, they are paired right now on the ice.
Green takes the puck, as Bill mentions, on defense with Langway. Up front, Messier. He's on now with Yari Gurry, who has the puck, and Wayne Gretzky. So Messier has replaced Tikkanen on the wing on this line. Gretzky centering for Messier, and it is broken up by Starikov. And the play broken up by the NHL. Gretzky looking, and the pass intercepted. Nice defensive work by Priyakin of the Soviet Union. Doug Wilson without the helmet to Gretzky. He avoids the check. Look at Curry wide open, and he shoots wide. They have hurried his shot just a bit. Just over 5 minutes remaining in the first period. Alexander Semak knocked out of the play. Priyakin taken out. And it's Ray Bourque playing with a bad groin injury. Thought he might not be able to go. He's here. Muller over to Doug Wilson. He steers it behind the net. It's Fedosov, the veteran at age 28 for the Soviet Union. Looks a little bit like Dennis Potvin of the New York Islanders as he comes to center ice. Over to Vladimir Krutov. Krutov, a slap shot, and that grazes off the edge of the post. In the corner, Ray Bourque with Makarov all over him. Bourque knocked down by Makarov. He has Larionov in front. There'll be a penalty coming up as Bourque hooks down Makarov from behind, and the NHL will play shorthanded. 4:26 to go in the first period here in Quebec City.
Reverse angle, we get a look at one of Wayne Gretzky's great qualities, peripheral vision. He was coming over, running into number 15, Asa Tikkanen, and Ken, from here, I could have sworn he had his back to Yari Gurry. He nevertheless threaded the needle right onto Curry's tape.
From the faceoff, the NHL playing shorthanded, clearing the puck away. The penalty at 15:34, 2 minutes for hooking to defenseman Ray Bourque. It's Sergei Makarov, trailed by Vladimir Krutov, number 9. At the left point, Kasatonov, he takes the puck. Back to Makarov. Krutov's in front. Krutov with a puck, shoots, and Fuhr gets a piece of that effort by Vladimir Krutov. Alexei Kasatonov, Sergei Makarov in front. Oh, and just unable to get his stick on the puck. Vyacheslav Fetisov, their premier defenseman.
And they set up decoys so well. They put two guys right in the slot to sag our entire box together and then run Fetisov wide behind everybody.
Still over a minute to go in the Ray Bourque penalty. 3.5 minutes to go in the first period. NHL All-Stars leading the Soviet national team 1-0. Kasatonov keeps the puck in. Larionov loses it to Samuelson. And the Swede, who plays with the Hartford Whalers, clears it away. Fetisov. Pass knocked away by Gretzky. Here's Samuelson. He's on defense with Ramsey. Gretzky and Curry up front killing the penalty. And the NHL clearing it the length of the ice. Belosheikin leaves it for his defense. NHL changing their defenseman on the penalty killing unit. Samak, number 30. And a pass intercepted by Gretzky. Yes, he can play tremendous two-way hockey. Verbukhin intercepting Curry. Verbukhin and Tatarinov on the points for the Soviet Union. On the power play up front, Semenov, Barnikov, and Svetlov. 15 seconds to go in the NHL penalty as Gretzky gets the puck. 2.5 minutes remaining in the first period. The NHL leads 1-0 on a Yari Gurry goal. Now, court back on. The NHL at full strength. Verbukhin for the Soviet Union. His feet is too far, and here's Mike Ramsey back. That hits Anderson in the skate. Bullen carries on. Anderson over the line onside. Omyutov back. Check Sandstrom. They wrestle each other down in the corner. Kaminsky can't get the puck out for the USSR. It's Anderson with Bullen in front, and Belosheikin knocks the puck away. Here is Starikov. Sergei Starikov. His pass stopped by Samuelson. Dave Poulin, the captain of the Flyers, to Mark Messier of Edmonton, shooting the puck in, and the NHL changes on the fly. That's something you don't see much of from the Soviet Union. There's a minute 40 remaining in the period. Stelnov can't get the puck out. Now Anderson after it, chased by Starikov. And the puck to center ice to Valery Kaminsky, the youngest Soviet player. He goes down. Goulet shoots it out. Gusarov, he's only 22, getting the puck ahead, and Bykov loses possession. He puts on the brakes. Chelios goes the other way, coughs up the puck, and Omyutov unable to play that pass as he headed into the slot. Chelios head manning to Claude Lemieux, on with Goulet. Belosheikin leaves the puck and then smothers it as big Claude Lemieux, the Montreal youngster, barrels in.
Boy, he doesn't want to do that in front of Claude Lemieux with no protection. Lemieux stuck out that left leg, Ken, and basically just rammed it right across the side of Belosheikin's arm and his body. And he is 6 feet tall to 6'1" in that range, 220 pounds is what he's listed at. And when he runs into, watch his left leg here. He sticks that left skate out there and decides he's going to take glove, stick, and half of Evgeny Belosheikin with him.
Just over a minute to go. First period, NHL All-Stars lead. Bill Clement, many things to talk about. One of the keys tonight, I know you felt coming into the two-game series, was control of the puck. Possession time, so to speak.
It was.
Oh, and the save by Belosheikin, and Goulet can't get the rebound.
I'll tell you why, Ken. They break down defensively when you control it for a while in their zone. That is the key to them breaking down, is us controlling it in their end.
And with 45 seconds to go, it would appear that the NHL All-Stars have done a pretty good job at controlling the puck. Certainly the Soviets have not dominated in this period. Both teams are at full strength. Here's a chance for the USSR. Priyakin in the corner, then Lemieux gets it. Mario Lemieux can't get the puck out. Rick Green clears to center ice. Alexander Semak, he is on with Amilov and Priyakin for the USSR, and Priyakin knocking the puck down. He's number 22, couldn't play it. Poulin hits it to Mario Lemieux, and he just backhands it with his back to the Soviet net into the Soviet zone. Down to 4 seconds to go here in the first period. And time runs out on a very entertaining first period here at the Coliseum in Quebec City. Game one of Rendezvous 87. And a weary 20-year-old netminder, Evgeny Belosheikin of the USSR. The only goal coming at 5:23. Yari Curry of the Edmonton Oilers from Wayne Gretzky and Esa Tikkanen, his two Edmonton teammates. Well, a lot of action to go. We're glad you're with us on ESPN. After a period, 1-0, the NHL All-Stars.
Well, I'm Tom Meese along with John Saunders. John, we have thawed out and seen a really good period of hockey. I'll be discussing the hockey doings with Bill Clement in a moment. But you've been the lucky man. You've been up here since Monday morning, and you've been sampling some of the nightlife, some of the parades, and some of the all-around fun and frivolity of this Rendezvous 87 in Quebec City.
As you know, this is my native home. I am a Quebecer. I grew up in Montreal. It is a tremendous thing. It was years ago here, centuries ago, that General Wolfe of the British fought General Montcalm of the French and reclaimed this land for English Canada. However, it has stayed very much French Canada. It is a tremendous country. We want you to sample some of the sights and some of the sounds from all around this beautiful city, Quebec City.
Thank you.
And welcome back to our Rendezvous 87 studios. Bill Clement has climbed down from atop the perch, high atop Le Colisée. Welcome down here.
Thank you. Much easier coming down than going up, I can assure you.
You will find that out in about 3 or 4 minutes. Bill, a crackling first period of hockey. I think the NHL fans have to be happy. Yari Curry scored the goal, but you brought out some keys before the game, other than goal scoring, some things the NHL had to do. One they had to do is eliminate quality shots for the Soviets.
They did. And, you know, I was sitting up there watching the entire period. I honestly can't remember them having one great quality shot on net. They were in position for a couple, Tom. But thanks to great block by Alf Samuelson, Dave Poulin had done one earlier. But this is Alf Samuelson's block. This is from just on the outside edge of the quality shot location. Oh, I'm sorry, that is the Dineen block along with Dave Poulin. Right. Later, Alf Samuelson block. And that really, those are the only two shots that I saw that were within that quality shot triangle. They really did a perfect job. They're very dangerous from in there.
Another point you brought out was that the young goaltender, Belosheikin, has a tendency to be up and down, and you were hoping if, from the NHL standpoint, he would be down. He allowed the goal by Curry. I don't think that was his fault, but he did come up with a spectacular save on Michel Goulet later in the period.
I thought he was very, very steady. I mentioned him as a key, and at times he can be inconsistent. Well, when the game started, it was evident to me that he was going to play a heck of a game. Goalies, no matter who they are, have difficulty in stopping the puck through the five hole. This one has a chance, comes close to going between his legs, but he recovers for the save. Ray Bourque driving for the net. And going back to the Yari Curry goal, Tom, it was for the five hole. It went between his legs. No goalie in the world can protect from that spot.
Okay, now Rod Langway, one of the veteran defensemen, of course, on the NHL All-Star team. And another point you made before the telecast, Bill, was that the NHL had to hit the Soviets, stop them from gathering that momentum before they could get their weaving and passing game into effect.
Exactly. And they do that in the neutral zone. That's where they gather their speed. They explode when they come across center heading towards our blue line. And Rod Langway stands up there with the best of them and just nailed one of the Soviets. He ended up taking two men out of the play. We're going to take a look at it here. Number 19, Varnikov, first of all. Langway stands him straight up, and it's kind of like a lineman in football. Notice how Langway started down on him and actually went up on him, knocked him down, then took a second man. Great defensive play. We played a heck of a first period.
I would say so. The National Hockey League fans, players, and coaches have to be happy. We'll see what lies ahead in the second period. Live from Le Colisée in a moment. Our score after one. The NHL All-Stars 1, the Soviets nothing. Rendezvous 87, game one of the two-game series against the Soviets. Yari Curry's goal has given the NHL All-Stars a 1-0 lead. We'll be back with the second period action in a moment. Our John Saunders has been out roaming the streets of Quebec City, looking at all the wonderful ice sculptures and creations of Rendezvous 87.
As the Soviet Union and NHL All-Stars fight it out to decide who's the best on the best in ice can be seen all around Quebec City this week. Certainly the theme has been ice sculptures at Rendezvous 87.
Traveling Quebec City today, saw all those ice sculptures firsthand. They are tremendous. And in case you're worrying about those sculptures melting under the TV lights, no, never happened. It's that cold in Quebec City. But the action is hot on the ice. We'll be back with more in a moment. Rendezvous 87, live from the Colisée in Quebec City. After one period, it's the NHL All-Stars 1 of the Soviet Union. Nothing, their national team coming over from Moscow a few days ago. You know, one of the keys to victory for the Soviets was to at least try and control Wayne Gretzky. We realize that nobody has found a way to stop him. Well, so far, Gretzky did have a hand in the lone goal of the first period. He didn't score it, but look at the assist. Number 99 holding the puck, holding it in the Soviet zone. And when you do that, the Soviets tend to be a little bit lax on defense. And Yari Curry one-times it through the five hole on Belosheikin, the goaltender of the Soviet Union. And that is the lone scoring play of the period. Wayne Gretzky raising his arms in triumph because he gets an assist on that goal. And on the scoring summary, it goes into the book as Yari Curry getting the goal at 5:23, assists to Wayne Gretzky and Asa Tikkanen. In other words, the Edmonton Oilers lead the Soviet Union by a score of 1-0. That's what it boils down to. What lies ahead in the second period? Stay with us on ESPN. Back to the Colisée in Quebec City. I'm Tom Meese. I'm all ready for the second period of play. And Ken Wilson and Bill Clement are ready as well. Gentlemen, let's go high atop the building for the second period.
We've had a lot of fun, certainly, to this point, Tom. And there are many things we're going to talk about over the two games here in Quebec City. Bill Clement, one thing we haven't touched on yet, defensemen, especially the NHL All-Stars. Defensemen, as they come back to stop the Soviet Union, you want them to hold that blue line.
Absolutely. That's why the play in the neutral zone is so important. The Soviets' forwards are such skilled players. They're skaters, stick handlers, and they can wheel and deal. We have to actually hold that blue line. Bob Johnson and Jean Perron, the NHL coaches, both admitted to us that blue line, that defensive blue line, is going to be a very, very important barrier to try and maintain against the Soviets.
And on the other hand, the Soviet defensemen are very good at staying up, so to speak, at the offensive blue line, and the NHL wants to do that. They want to keep the defensemen close to their forward unit.
Exactly. When the Russians are playing offensively, they try and spread us out. Therefore, it's very important for us to stick together going both ways, whether we're heading offensively or defensively.
There is a look at the Soviet Union. They find themselves trailing in this hockey game by a score of 1-0. Yari Curry getting the goal early in the first period. Everyone very pleased with the way things have gone for the NHL All-Stars. The key seemed to be the first 10 minutes, and certainly Jean Perron, the coach of the NHL, had said, if we can get out of the first period 0-0, we'll be on the right track. Well, Bill, puck control, we talked about it, some statistics.
Face-offs pretty even. Shoot-ins, we mean getting to center ice and dumping it in and then chasing it. It's interesting to note that the Soviets had 5 shoot-ins, as did we. Usually that statistic is lopsided. We do that on our side of the body of water far more often than they do. Turnovers, look at this. 24 by the Soviet Union, and you can bet that a lot of those were forced turnovers. Quality shots, well, the Soviet Union had 4. They were borderline quality shots from that outside edge. We had 7. There's no question. I could tell early that Evgeny Belosheikin was a big factor holding in the Soviets early.
And the second period is underway here in Quebec City. Rick Green unable to shoot the puck in. He has it again. He's on defense with Langway. Dumps it in, and it bounds right to Belosheikin. A chance for Vyacheslav Fedosov, getting it ahead to Krutov. Krutov is on with Larionov and Makarov. Makarov, number 24, trying to steal the puck from Green, and he's unable to. This is Kevin Dineen, the winger from the Hartford Whalers. On with Howard Chuck and Poulin. Shooting it in, here's Dave Poulin, trying to center. Kasatonov blocks the puck away. Larionov doesn't see it, number 11, but he takes out Howard Chuck. Now Fedosov, number 2, the strong veteran Soviet defenseman, and he runs into Poulin, and Fedosov wobbly gets up. Poulin centers, a bouncing puck in front, and it's cleared away by Alexei Kasatonov, the Soviet defenseman.
That's the kind of forechecking we need, Ken. Poulin just about ran over Fedosov, and Fedosov is a big man, 205, 210 pounds. Dave Poulin buried him behind the net.
There's just over a minute gone in the second period. Here's Makarov. Krutov. He tries to get around Samuelson. Krutov in the corner. And big Ulf Samuelson takes him out. Messier to Ramsey. Ramsey stopped at center ice. Semenov can't make a play. And Belosheikin wheels the puck around the boards. Svetlov on with Semenov. And Barnikov. Messier intercepts to Anderson. He fans. Chelios can't keep the puck in. Look out here. Sergei Svetlov. Svetlov one-on-one with Bork. And the backhand shot stopped by Fuhr as Sergei Svetlov had a good chance there. Then Tatarinov at center ice having trouble. Messier with a puck over the line to Glenn Anderson. He shoots and it off the goalpost. It goes off the goalpost after Belosheikin gets a piece of it. in front, grabbing the puck. Pervukin for the Soviets can't clear. The shot by Curry deflects wide. This is Messier. He's bottled up along the boards. And the puck held for a faceoff. 2 minutes, 2 seconds into the second period with the NHL up 1-0.
Boy, Ken, it sure looks to me like we got the switches on the attack mode. Marc Messier having a good chance. Perhaps should have elected to shoot. He actually tried to feed Anderson. Anderson fanned on it. Then there was a misplay at the point. And then Anderson came back. This is our reverse angle super slow-mo. Here's the shot off the post. Looked like Evgeny Belosheikin got a slight piece of that, didn't it? Meanwhile, at the other end, Grant Fuhr following the shooter so well, actually making the save on Svetlov.
From the faceoff, the puck deflects into the crowd, and there'll be a faceoff outside the Soviet blue line. That's the youngster who had a good chance in the first period, 20-year-old Valery Kamensky.
Again, there were a lot of people that weren't sure whether he'd play or not, but people that have seen him play recently said, I do not understand how they can keep him off the team. Sure enough, here he is, tall player, very aggressive, very long stride. When he gets in tight, he can put that puck up into the top of the net as well as anyone here or in the Soviet Union.
On defense, Starikov getting the puck out. His team was Stelnov. Up front, Kamensky between Mikov and Homyutov for the Soviet Union. Back for the puck, Starikov. It comes up on the wing, and it's Homyutov shoveling into the middle to the defenseman, Igor Stelnov, who celebrates birthday 24 tomorrow. Unable to send it, and the puck trickles in front. It's Stelnov again, behind the net to Homyutov. Homyutov looking in front and unable to get a good shot is Bykov. Bykov, number 27, wrestling for the puck, taken out by Yari Curry. Now Kamensky trying to muscle Green. Stelnov whacks the puck behind the net to Kamensky, and the Soviet Union is dangerous. Here early in the second period, and big Wayne Gretzky with a puck. Gretzky showing some Soviet-like moves, and the feed to Langway out of his reach. Starikov, number 12, to number 4, Stelnov. They're a defense mate team. They're a Red Army crew with Homyutov, Kamensky, and Bykov. Back for the puck for the NHL All-Stars, Rick Green. He's on defense with Langway, who takes over. Langway being charged a bit by Priokin, gets the puck to Gretzky. Rink wide. Claude Lemieux trying to get around Gusarov and tied up by Gusarov. Priokin in the middle. Samak, Popchek, but carrying on and getting the puck ahead is Belly Lechtanov. Soviets with an opportunity and the save on Samak by Fjord. Pittsburgh Penguins star Mario Lemieux to Michel Goulet, and the return pass for Mario Lemieux doesn't click. Mike Ramsey playing the puck over to his defense mate, and it comes to Goulet, the Quebec Nordique star. Michel Goulet plays it off the boards, and taking over is Belly Lechtanov, a veteran, the oldest Soviet player. He wears number 14. It's 1-0, NHL All-Stars. That's Belly Lechtanov making the stop, and Belly Lechtanov comes right in front to Krutov. Oh, and the save on Krutov by Fuhr on a setup by the veteran, Zinatula Belly Lechtanov.
Boy, he learned about Grant Fuhr there, Ken. He thought he had all kinds of time. Fuhr would slide across, but Fuhr stacked the pads and got them up so high he had nowhere to go. Had he let it go right away, I think he would have scored.
This is Dineen. His pass is broken up. It's Belly Lechtanov again. He's 31 years of age, the oldest Soviet. NHL dumping the puck back in. Igor Larionov getting it around to Vladimir Krutov by him. And the NHL in possession. Here's Doug Wilson. On the wing, Kurt Mahler. Oh, what a glove save by Belosheikin on the former member of the 84 Canadian Olympic team, Kurt Mahler. At Quebec City, Rendezvous 87, Game 1. The NHL leads 1-0.
Well, we talked about Grant Fuhr being back and sharp on top of his game. He has certainly been that, Ken, in the first period. Here's the shot that Krutov delayed. It looked to me as if he got the puck, stopped it, looked around, took another little look, very split second, let it go a little late. Boy, there are a couple of big names there.
Wilt Chamberlain on the left, the soccer great Pelé on the right. They have been here with other sports and hockey greats at the Hockey Hall of Fame signing autographs.
Look at Wayne Gretzky back in deep helping out. This is certainly something that he is aware that he has to do. He's been doing it more this year with the Oilers as well. Really become a better defensive player. That time he was way, way back in deep helping out.
Shots on goal in this second period. The Soviets 3, the NHL All-Stars 2. So far in this contest, the Soviets have outshot. The Soviets have outshot the NHLers 13-8.
There's number 19, Mikhail Varnikov. He is the only player on this Soviet national team that is not from one of the four teams that is located actually in Moscow. He plays for Gorky Torpedo team. And I guess his line mates would have been here with him had they not been so old. That's what we were told by the Soviet announcers yesterday.
NHL leading 1-0. Second period, Messier on with Sandstrom. The pass back. And Green can't play it. It's Anderson, Sandstrom, and Messier up front. Langway and Green on the defense for the NHL All-Star team. 5:35 has been played in this middle period. Belosheikin leaving the puck for Perbuk, and ooh, and a close call right there. There's a break in the action. Back to Quebec in just a moment.
Here's a look at Belosheikin mishandling this. He kind of la-di-da-ed here, Ken, and I noticed him do that earlier in the first period and wondered if that was just a one-time thing, but he really wasn't that sharp with it on that particular play.
Yari Curry's goal early in the first period is the difference. Curry is on with Gretzky and Tikkanen. Starikov losing the puck. Yari Curry, and he's poke-checked by Starikov. Kaminsky for the USSR. On with Bykov and Homyutov. Here's Staranov. Oh, and a shot right there, and Fuhr, having to play tough as Curry gets the puck to Bork, but not out. And finally, poked to center ice. Tikkanen can't reach it. The Soviets trying to maintain possession in the neutral zone. Kaminsky getting up right in front of the NHL All-Star bench, loses the puck, and then Chelios in turn loses it to Bykov, number 27. Looking for Kaminsky. Now Homyutov right in front of the slot, and he takes a swing and a puck that never reached him. Homyutov moving in front. He's got a bit of a screen, and Fuhr makes a save on Andre Homyutov. Good forechecking here by the Soviet Union. Starikov, and that shot wide. Kaminsky, he's bothered by Bork. That allows Chris Chelios to get the puck. NHL leading the Soviets 1-0. Esa-Tikkanen, and oh, and he can't quite get it through to Chelios. Here's Sergei Priyakin, number 22 for the Soviet Union. Oh, and a quick wrist shot, and Fuhr has to be alert there as Priyakin lets one go. The NHL clearing the puck the length of the ice. It's icing as Alexei Gusarov touches it. We're in Quebec City, the opening game of Rendezvous 87. The stick on the bench, the player Wayne Gretzky. 7 times he's won the Hart Trophy, the MVP in the NHL. Number 99, he is legend worldwide.
Don't think these Soviets don't know all about Wayne Gretzky or Mario Lemieux. They dream of the NHL over there, perhaps not as vividly or as in many vivid colors as kids on this continent, but they nevertheless dream about the National Hockey League.
Gusarov for the Soviets. Up front now, it's Amalov, Samak, and Priyakin for the Soviet Union. Covering up Gusarov. Playing the puck around to Priyakin. He lets it go, and it's Ramsey for the NHL. Out to Holt Samuelson, the Swede. Tomas Sandstrom, the other Swede on the NHL team. Gusarov again. Priyakin. Lanky Soviet forward. Krutov breaks for the slot. He overskates it, as did Belly Leptinov. Back comes the NHL, led by Goulet. Claude Lemieux breaks for the net and tries to just deflect it by goaltender Belosheikin, and he's unable to, as the two French Canadians, Claude Lemieux and Michel Goulet, attempt to combine. Rod Langway touches the puck. That's a rare icing against the Soviet national team. Well, Rod Langway, one of the Americans playing in this two-game affair, 3 players. Langway actually born in Taiwan, but grew up in the Boston area in Randolph. Of course, the other U.S. players, Chris Chelios and Mike Ramsey, also defensemen. Rod Langway started his NHL career with Montreal and, of course, a star with Washington.
And does he stand out? 6'3", 215 pounds. These Soviet players, Ken, are not in general as big as we are. That big line of theirs, Makarov, 5'9", 160 pounds. Larionov, 5'8", 155. But they combine strength and power and agility on the ice, along with balance, and they are very, very strong when you meet them head-on on the ice.
We just saw Soviet coach Viktor Tikhonov pointing out to one of his players, giving that circular motion, and the Soviets love to do that. One side of the ice to the other, circle around, keep moving, and that's one of the keys for the NHL All-Stars. They don't usually play that way. Maybe the Edmonton Oilers do a bit. Maybe Gretzky, Tikkanen, and Curry do a little bit, but it's not the North American pattern.
You have to have very, very skilled players to be able to do that and execute very well, and there aren't that many teams that can do it in the National Hockey League.
Bedosov robbed on a super save by Grant Fuhr. Up from the defense, Vyacheslav Fedosov, what a save.
And after the save, Fedosov looked up to the ceiling here at the Quebec Colisée and just shook it and saying, man, I was robbed right here. Look at this shot. He had a lot to shoot at there, too. Fuhr had to come up for it. Here's our reverse angle look at it. Nice pass, landing right on Fedosov. We talked about him being an offensive defenseman as well as a defensive defenseman. He is their leader and can do it all. And we talked about them actually being up on the play. He was more than up on the play. He was actually coming right through. That puts a big, big strain on the forwards whose duties are to actually watch the Soviet point men when we get into our end.
And what a pass made by Sergei Makarov. He made a Gretzky-like pass into the slot to Fedosov, and the Soviets there with one of their best scoring chances of the game. Now the NHL, a pass for Pulenstop, and the Soviets move on the attack, led by Vladimir Krutov. Here's Makarov again, wedged to the board by Langway. Dale Howardchuk of the Winnipeg Jets to Dave Poulin, the spunky centerman of the Philadelphia Flyers. Pushed by Konstantinov, then a drive by Dineen, and a good save there by Belosheikin.
Boy, Dineen did a heck of a job on teeing that up. He was on his off wing, and when those passes come out of the corner, very, very difficult to get your body twisted around in the proper attitude to get rid of it. Out of the right of your screen, we might see him showing up, just getting enough wood on it to pop it on Belosheikin. You could see he was a right-hand shot, and the pass was coming out of the corner. But at the other end, Ken, that save earlier that Grant Fuhr made on Fedosov, it pointed out to me how much we might miss Paul Coffey in a two-game series like this. How many times have we seen Paul Coffey do just what Vyacheslav Fedosov did, cut for that net, open things up, and actually score as a defenseman by cutting in? Mark Howe does it very well, too. He's not here. Ray Bourque is the third best at it in the league, and he is not healthy.
Puck in the Soviet zone. And played out. Shot the length of the ice by Tatarinov. That's icing against the Soviet Union. So Paul Coffey, Mark Howe, Mike Bossy, all not here, out with bad backs. Those are the three players missing tonight for the NHL. Quebec City, Canada, 10:58 left, second period. The NHL All-Stars won, the Soviet national team nothing. We mentioned Coffey, Howe, Bossy, all out with injuries. Tim Kerr pulled a thigh in practice earlier today, and the big goal scorer of the Philadelphia Flyers is not suited up tonight. Norman Rochefort, the Nordiques defenseman, who had been working out, is not dressed. He may play Friday night. And the third goalie, Ron Hextall, is not dressed. The backup goalie is Clint Malarchuk from Quebec. There's a quick shot by Messier, and Belosheikin makes another save for the Soviet Union.
Boy, number six, Tatarinov of the Soviet Union, Ken, there he is. Glenn Anderson took his feet out from under him. This kid is a bull. He's one of the young bucks on this team, one of the new breed of very aggressive Soviet players. He got up to his feet once Anderson had leveled him. As a look at there, he is going down. He gets up, look at his direction, right back to Glenn Anderson. Here's our reverse angle look at him. Muller just tries to get it on the net, but Semenov knocks it off with his stick. Messier, that was a shot out of midair, and Tatarinov was screening Belosheikin a little bit. Watch Anderson come in. Think that was accidental?
I'm glad it didn't happen at a border spot. Belosheikin again from the faceoff. There's no question that could easily have been a two-minute penalty to Glenn Anderson.
No question. And speaking of border spots, talking about the Soviet Union hockey system, I mentioned earlier four of the teams are in the Soviet Union. One of them is Dynamo, one is Soviet Wings, Moscow at least. One of them is the Wings, one is the Red Army. The Dynamo team is sponsored by the Border Guards and the KGB.
They have an interesting system in the Soviet Union, and we'll be telling you about their first division National League pro team, of which all of these players come from that make up the Soviet national team. We'll get into that more tonight and again on Friday night in game two. You're a big save there. Tikkanen to Gretzky to Curry. Three on three. Tikkanen in the middle for Curry. Back to help out. Bykov. Then Anderson or check it. Gretzky in front to Curry. And Curry can't get a good stick on the puck as Gretzky set up Yari Curry. Here's Bykov. Omatov. He's spun around. And the NHL taking possession and clearing out and all the way back to the Soviet goal. There's 9:50 left in the second period as Belosheikin just holds on to the puck for a faceoff deep in Soviet territory.
Ken, we talked about puck control and how the Soviets can have a tendency to break down when you can control that puck for long enough. Wayne Gretzky did it so well in behind their net. Belosheikin here freezing the puck as Tikkanen comes in to throw a little snow at him. Here's Yari Curry moving in front. About puck control, Wayne Gretzky set up office behind the net. Nobody in the most dangerous area of the ice, 15 feet out in front of the net. Curry just either fanned on it or had it bounce over his stick.
Here's Amalov. He's 29, number 29, 22 years of age in the NHL, breaks up the play. Green on defense with Langway, who takes the pass. Up front, Mario Lemieux. His slap shot goes into the crowd off the stick of Alexei Gusarov. This is the French-Canadian line that Coach John Perron has on now. That's Mario Lemieux, only 21, with Claude Lemieux at 21 with him. And on the other wing, the veteran, four-time 50-goal scorer, Michel Goulet.
I'm wondering how effective his knee is, Ken. He was injured 6 weeks ago. A couple of months ago, came back and played a couple of games, was doing well, but he re-injured it, was taken off the ice in a game last weekend against the New Jersey Devils. I'm not sure that he is at full speed. If he gets a little rest and doesn't bother it tonight, we could see a different Mario by Friday night.
Mario Lemieux has quite an extensive, strong brace protecting his right knee as he plays here tonight in Quebec City. Game one of Rendez-vous 87, two-game series between the NHL All-Stars and the Soviet national team. It's 1-0. NHL All-Stars, just over 9 minutes remaining in the second period as Langway takes over. We're glad you're with us here on ESPN, part of the worldwide coverage of this unique one-time-only two-game series. Priyakin trying to get the puck through, and Mario Lemieux ends up with it. Playing it to Claude Lemieux, no relation. Gusarov, he's stopped. Here's the NHL on the attack. Goulet just out of the reach of Claude Lemieux, and the All-Stars from the NHL will change players. A look at Priyakin over the line with Samak. Samak is in the slot, but the puck stolen away by Chris Chelios. Chelios out of the University of Wisconsin. Head manning the puck to Dineen, and Goulet just deflects it in. Back for it. Zinatula. Veliletinov. The 31-year-old veteran defenseman. Fedosov getting the puck out. It's Makarov. Trailed by Larionov. But Makarov, a good move around Bork. Centers. Oh, and there'll be a penalty. A penalty as Vladimir Krutov was sent end over end. Belosheikin goes to the bench. Play continues until the NHL All-Stars touch the puck. The NHL will be picking up a penalty. This is Kasatonov. Makarov. Still a delay penalty coming against the NHL. Omyutov is poke check. Igor Larionov gets the puck. The fans here feel that the NHL has touched the puck. And finally, referee Nikolai Morozov from the USSR stops play. The NHL picks up a penalty here in the second period. They lead in this game 1-0.
Well, we are still holding them off. Grant Fuhr just doing a wonderful job in goal for us. This is one of those must penalties, Ken. It's number 10, Dale Hawerchuk yanking down Krutoff, putting him into the net, but boy, had he not taken him down. Got to keep in mind, this number 9, Krutoff, has led their elite league in goal scoring 4 of the last 5 years. Super slow-mo from our reverse angle, Chris Chelios sneaking up on number 29 of the Soviet Union, Sergei Priyakhin.
Penalty to Hawerchuk. First penalty of this scoreless second period. 12:28, the time of the hooking penalty. All 3 penalties in this game have been called against the NHL All-Stars. The Soviet power play, obviously 0-2. Yari Kurri's early first period goal, the only goal tonight here in game 1 of Rendezvous 87. NHL All-Stars up front, Messier and Muller killing the penalty. On the blue line, Langway and Green. And Kirk Muller comes up with a punt for the NHL. He's checked by Fedosov. And on the move, the Soviet Union, Sergei Makarov. Leaving it for Kasatonov to Krutoff. Here's Krutoff moving around Messier. Looking back to Kasatonov, number 7, Krutoff, number 9. And certainly number 9 on the sweater behooves a tremendous international star. Kaminsky, the youngster, playing up front in the middle. Or check it, Larionov. Larionov, number 11, between Krutoff, 9, and Makarov, 24, up front on the power play. Kasatonov, that goes off the stick of Messier. Messier without a stick, as his blade was broken off from the shaft. Larionov, trying to get the puck to Makarov. Langway can't clear. Fedosov, Makarov. 40 seconds to go in the penalty. And that Kasatonov shot deflected wide, and Kurt Muller backhands the puck the length of the ice. Just over 6 minutes left, second period. It's 1-0 NHL. There's Kaminsky, the youngster, number 13. Larionov, Fedosov, he can handle it. To Kaminsky, cutting right in, and Fuhr makes the save on Valery Kaminsky. The Soviet Union has been stopped cold in the first 2 periods by sensational play from Grant Fuhr. Makarov giving the puck off. Fedosov at the point for Larionov, can't keep the puck in. Here's Wayne Gretzky. Short-handed, the NHL. And a return pass from Kurri fails to reach Gretzky. 5.5 minutes to go in the middle period. Homyatov with Kaminsky. Kaminsky ridden out of the play, and Homyatov sends the puck behind the net. And Ramsey plays it there, but a penalty will be called, and I believe it'll be a penalty for too many men on the ice, called by...
Boy, this is playoff hockey in a certain sense, Ken. And we talk about how important goaltending is. Watch Grant Fuhr, the National League team, on this save with young Valery Kaminsky rolling in. Kaminsky's a right-hand shot. It's really interesting to note that the Soviets only have 3 or 4 players that ever play on their national team that are right-hand shots. He gets in behind our defense. Grant Fuhr standing his ground. He did pretty well picking up Ramsey coming in out of the corner of his eye, or he could have gone wide, but Ramsey was definitely there to cut him off at the pass.
Soviet Union finding themselves down 1-0. Too many men on the ice against the Soviet team. 14:37, the time of the penalty. It'll be served by Valery Kaminsky.
Kind of an uncharacteristic penalty, Ken, too, of a team that prides itself on its discipline, isn't it?
That's a very good point, Bill. You would not expect that from the Soviets. Bork getting the puck behind the net, gets it back. Doug Wilson is at the left point. Bork also supposed to be at a point. Bork in front. Oh, and somehow Hawerchuk turns it just wide as Dale Hawerchuk was set up by Ray Bork. Bork's at the right point. Doug Wilson at the left point. Gretzky, Messier, and Hawerchuk up front. There's a lot of firepower on this NHL All-Star power play. The first of the night for them. Gretzky softly to Bork. Homatov blocks the shot. Homatov and Bikov are the forwards up front, killing the penalty as Belosheikin makes a good save. Messier to Gretzky, in front for Hawerchuk, and an alert move by the young goaltender Belosheikin.
2 consecutive excellent hockey plays, one by Ray Bork on a pass, the second, Belosheikin helping himself right through the crease, Ken.
The NHL with a man advantage. They lead 1-0. Over 4 minutes remaining in the second period. Here in game 1 at Quebec City as Gretzky moves into Kurri in front for Anderson. Belosheikin makes the save. And the Soviets clear the puck. the length of the ice.
Boy, Belosheikin knew the puck was coming out front. He never did give way that short side. He held that one left skate right against the post.
Half a minute left in the Soviet penalty for too many men on the ice. Puck cleared away by Pervukin. Pervukin in the corner for the Soviets. Into the boards by Curry. And the referee stopped play with 3:46 to go in the second period. And we have seen some tremendously skilled and entertaining hockey here tonight in game one of Rendezvous 87.
Can you imagine the luxury of having a Dale Hawerchuk of the Winnipeg Jets and Wayne Gretzky? There they are sitting beside each other. Gretzky 99 on your left. Out there on the same power play. Imagine if they threw Mario Lemieux out there as well. Here is Hawerchuk in front. That pass jammed him a little bit. And by jamming, I mean it wasn't right on his forehand side. He had to actually move his stick in between his feet. Wasn't able to direct it at the net properly, or stop it for that matter, before he shot.
Soviets control and get the puck out. Less than 20 seconds left in the Soviet penalty. NHL All-Stars leading 1-0. After the puck, Mario Lemieux. He's on with Anderson and Curry up front. Bork and Wilson are on the points. Len Anderson back to Ray Bork, but he is really rushed on the play. After the puck for the Soviet Union is Semenov. U.S.S.R. is back at full strength as Doug Wilson and Semenov tangle. Here's Yari Curry. He's dead tired. On the attack, Curry just shoots the puck in and heads for the bench. Len Anderson trying to bound away, and he does. Here's Anderson spinning and finally scores! Len Anderson makes it 2-0 for the NHL All-Stars.
And it looked to me as if Belosheikin tried to help himself too much on this. He was trying to cut the pass with his stick. Look where his stick is. He knew that Glenn Anderson had somebody on this side of the net, and as soon as he put his stick out, we'll watch it. This is a great angle to watch it from. Watch Belosheikin try to cut the pass to Dineen with his stick a little bit. He actually left a hole between his legs. Mario Lemieux in on the play. You know that he's a part of every power play that he is on, a big part of it. Here is Belosheikin. Well, you know, from that angle, he didn't try and cut the pass that much, but his stick was out there trying to help himself. Perhaps the angle of his stick was a little flat, because Anderson was able to get the puck right over his stick, right between Belosheikin's legs.
Len Anderson, who played his college hockey briefly at the University of Denver, scores at 17 minutes of the second period. Mario Lemieux gets the assist. It is 2-0 NHL. Goulet a pass broken up by Briakin. He gets the puck back from Hamilov. Priyakin trying to cut in, forced behind the net. Bulin feeds up on the wing nicely to Goulet. And it's Claude Lemieux after the puck with Gusarov. They battle for it. And the Soviet Union is in possession of the puck. Billy Letnikov getting the puck to Gusarov. Pass to Makarov, broken up. Gusarov to Krutov. Krutov loses the puck, and Langway clears it back to the Soviet blue line. Billy Letnikov clearing to center ice. Bulin intercepts. A delayed offside, but the NHL clears the zone. Krutov getting the puck to Makarov with Larionov over the line, and they're stopped. The centerman, Igor Larionov, with a puck for the Soviets. Now Fedosov circling in his own end. Intercepting, shooting Muller. Oh, Kurt Muller as the Soviets get careless. Kazatona around to Krutov. He can't get the puck out. Dineen in front. Then Muller. Muller robbed by Belosheikin. And the NHL has had some tremendous chances here in the second period. Here's Larionov. He goes down. Krutov takes a hit from Ramsey. Makarov centering. Kazatona can't get a shot. And they shoot and score. The Soviets. The defenseman, Alexei Kazatona, moving into the slot. And the Soviets get their first goal as they finally beat Grant Fuhr.
Fuhr will not be happy with this one, Ken. He somehow misplays it with his glove, and fair is fair. We've had two between Belosheikin's legs. This one pops right between Grant Fuhr's legs. He tries to close his legs in desperation, realizing that he's missed it with his right hand. But to no avail. We'll take a look at it from this angle. Kazatona moves in. Looks like a routine shot.
Not much of a shot, really, by Alexei Kosatonov. He had trouble handling the puck, really.
Well, the pass was on his backhand, so he had to control it before he even teed it up. I'm not sure Grant wasn't caught in the middle a little bit. Shall I catch it? Should I take it with my stick? One way or the other, he was handcuffed, and it's 2-1.
NHL All-Stars lead. Bykov shot knocked out. Bullet for the NHL. Broken up at center ice. 18:42, the time of the goal. The assist goes to Makarov. The goal to Kosatonov. There's Chris Chelios, born in Chicago, played hockey in the Evergreen Park area until he was 14, moved to San Diego, went to Mira Mesa High School, tried out for the U.S. International College team, and was cut. Went up to play hockey as an amateur in Canada, went to Wisconsin, and the rest is history.
Take a look at Doug Wilson getting in tight with Semenov. Wilson has a hold of his sticks, and when you get in that tight with his strength, he switched from the stick to the sweater. He dragged it down.
There is less than a minute to go in the second period. And the NHL All-Stars, just quickly after the face-off or call in the play, will bring a face-off inside of the USSR blue line. The NHL now with Messier at center, Poulin and Anderson on the wing.
There's a look at Igor Stelnov. He's a hard-hitting defenseman, kind of a defensive-style defenseman. They always look to Fetisov and Kosatonov, that defensive pair on the first unit, to create a lot of the offense. He is capable of playing offense, but he plays pretty good defense out there, as they do. They have a nice mix. They're very similar to a lot of teams in the National Hockey League. They have players that are more offensive, players that are more defensive.
Bill, I think the thing I expected to see the most of, and I have not seen tonight, after watching the Soviets in practice and on tape, they seem to be such tremendous skaters. I'm feeling that they're not getting the opportunity to skate as much as they would like tonight here in Quebec City.
These players are well informed. We talked about it before the game. We have to neutralize the Soviet speed. Thus far, I'd say we've done a real commendable job. The breakdowns in our own end can vary, I think, are a result of us not having played together, the National Hockey League team not having played together before tonight. You have to learn how to communicate. You actually have to learn how players move on the ice, what their instincts are. And the National Hockey League team has not had a chance to do that.
Now 25 seconds remaining in the second period. Both teams have scored once in this period. The NHL leads 2-1. Fedosov unable to make the final move. He can't get around Tikkanen. And play is stopped by the Soviet referee, Nikolai Morozov, with 14 seconds to go. One of the things we've talked about is goalies, Bill, and we have seen Grant Fuhr absolutely terrific, especially early in this period, then gives up maybe a soft goal. We've seen Belosheikin on the other end give up a goal. He did his best against Anderson, but it certainly wasn't a tremendously skilled goal that beat him.
It's definitely a key, Ken. It will continue to be a key, especially with the score this tight. We're getting into the third period, and number 9, Krutov, is going to be on Grant Fuhr's door before this game is over.
Yari Kurri scored the initial goal early in the first period. And it was a very pretty, pure play, Gretzky to Kurri out in front. Puck cleared out by Chelios. Here's Denis dumping it in. 3 seconds remaining. Kosatonov sends the puck to center ice. That is the end of the second period here in game one of Rendezvous 87 in Quebec City. So to recap the scoring for you in the second period, the NHL takes a 2-0 lead. Glenn Anderson from Mario Lemieux at 1700, and then Kosatonov from Makarov at 1842 for the Soviet Union. What reaction? A happy NHL All-Star, Glenn Anderson. The All-Stars lead the Soviets 2-1.
Finished 2 periods of game one of our two-game series of Rendezvous 87, the NHL All-Stars against the best from the Soviet Union. 2-1 after 2 periods. The NHL is on top, maintaining that 1-goal lead they had after 1 period. You know, Rendezvous 87 and the Quebec Winter Carnival has turned out this year to be, yes, a festival of hockey, as we're seeing right now, but also it's been a festival of different cultures. John Saunders has been sampling some of the cultural festivities around Quebec City, and he takes a look at the gastronomical delight and the Festival of Music.
A wise man once said, man cannot live on hockey alone, so it's appropriate with the best from the NHL and the Soviet Union here in Quebec that they take care of the appetite in an all-star sort of way as well. Some of the best chefs from the United States, Canada, and the Soviet Union have teamed up to serve up a 10-course gastronomic delight.
The evening began with cocktails featuring a pageantry of international attire. Over 1,500 guests were invited to take part in the special 10-course gourmet menu prepared by culinary teams from all over the world. Musicians, entertainers, hosts, and honorary guests gave the spectacular evening all its splendor. Meanwhile, over at Le Colisée, audiences were entertained by Russian music sung by the famed Red Army Choir. The choral group, directed by Boris Alexander, performed repertoires of anthems and classics.
Some beautiful pictures of very scenic Quebec City. When the sun shines, even on a cold day, it's very, very beautiful. And we're seeing some beautiful hockey being played by the NHL All-Stars and the Soviet Union. I'm Tom Mees in company again with Bill Clement. Bill, the goaltenders, of course, in any big game or big series, the goaltenders are going to come into play. Belosheikin and Fuhr both had their shining moments. We'll pick it up. First thing we're going to look at is a save by Belosheikin in the second period.
Well, I mentioned it in the booth, Tom, that this is playoff hockey in a sense because there's so much pressure and we're looking at such great, great hockey teams. We also mentioned before the show that Belosheikin could be inconsistent. Tonight, thus far, I don't think he's been inconsistent at all, especially for a guy that's 20 years old. He has been very, very steady. He's come up with a number of excellent saves, and as far as I'm concerned, really has held the Soviet team in early.
There you see Glenn Anderson closing in on the doorstep, and Belosheikin getting the left pad out there and the glove to cover up on any rebound.
One of the keys there is that he holds his posts very, very well. Mm-hmm. You notice that even when the play seems to be going from his left to his right, as he's moving across, he drags that leg back there to make sure that he cuts off the short side shot, and he's positionally an excellent, excellent goalie.
Well, Belosheikin has played well for the most part. Grant Fuhr has been nothing short of sensational, especially with that quick glove hand of his.
Yes, he had that one letdown that was on the goal, but besides that, he has been excellent. He is cat-like quick, recovers from the first save very well in order to position himself for the second save. We're going to take a look at the great glove save on Fetisov, who cuts in so well. And Paul Coffey came to mind immediately when I saw that, Tom. I wonder how much we're going to miss him before this is all over, along with Mark Howe. They move into that slot area and actually become attackers so well.
Now, the NHL forechecking has also been very, very good, especially at center ice. We've seen a lot of center ice play, and forechecking, if you are persistent at it, will eventually lead to a goal. It led to a goal for Glenn Anderson of the Edmonton Oilers and the NHL All-Star.
Well, the Soviets can be forechecked. There's no question about it. Their defensemen, in general, are very, very mobile. But Yari Kurri dumps the puck deep into the Soviet zone, and the National Hockey League team is on the charge here. Anderson actually just swoops around, beats the Soviet player to the puck, and it's dumped back into the corner by Belosheikin. Now Mario Lemieux has it for a split second, and that's long enough for him to do some magic with it. Anderson wheels around. Belosheikin's stick is at a flat angle. Yep. Notice how it was. Originally, when I saw that, I thought that he was playing the pass. As it turned out, he was angry with himself, not for having played the pass and guessed wrong, but for having his stick so far advanced in front of him that Anderson was actually able to get it over the flat stick and between his legs. You can't stop between the legs once the shot's coming.
One quick comment. If you're an NHL fan sitting at home tonight, do you have to be happy with a 2-1 lead after two?
I think so. The first half of the game for the National Hockey League team was going to be very, very important. With a 2-1 lead, at least, they're sitting very, very pretty.
All right, it should be a great third period of hockey. You, the hockey fans, are the winners tonight, no matter which team comes out on top. Rendezvous 87 continues from Quebec in a moment.
You don't just watch an NHL game, you feel it. Feel the power, the speed. Feel the strength, the grace. The magic. NHL hockey. Feel the thunder.
Welcome back live to Le Colisée. I'm Tom Mies. We'll be going back live for the third period, which should be an exciting ending to what has been an exciting game tonight, game one of our two-game series, Rendezvous 87. Only two goals in the period, but there were several highlights we want to show you. First of all, the NHL with a legitimate scoring chance on the stick of number 9, Glenn Anderson. Of course, he's the great player from the Edmonton Oilers, cutting in from the right faceoff circle, snaps a drive, and look at this. He hits the post on the outside. He came that close to scoring. Glenn Anderson really was unfortunate there. He had beaten Belosheikin. Now, on the other end, Grant Fuhr has just been, as we said a few minutes ago, Bill Clement and I said, just been sensational in the pipes for the National Hockey League. Again, Fuhr covering the angle and making sure that any rebound would come out to his defenseman and not give the Soviets another chance. But as great as Fuhr was, he's probably talking to himself about the Soviet goal. Alexei Kasatinov in front, and Fuhr appeared to have that one lined up in front of him, but it went under his glove and between his legs, and a big goal for the Soviets. That made it obviously from a 2-0 game to a 2-1 game, and you would be hard-pressed to find many people who would feel that the NHL could shut the Soviets out in the third period. We shall see what we shall see. Now, Glenn Anderson's goal, of course, gave the NHL All-Stars a 2-0 lead. Again, Mario Lemieux, the only assist on this goal at the 17-minute mark. And look at Anderson. I think he had Belosheikin a little bit off balance there. The old wraparound, and Belosheikin doesn't get his stick down in proper positioning through the legs. And that goal made it 2-0 after two periods. It is the NHL All-Stars 2, the Soviet Union All-Stars 1. We'll be back to Le Colisée in Quebec City in just a moment. 100. Rendezvous 87 is being brought to you by Chrysler Plymouth. We're working to be the best. And by the U.S. Navy. Live the adventure. And by Teleflora. Beautiful fresh flowers and exclusive keepsake. Your florist can send one anywhere. Rendezvous 87 continues on ESPN all week, and we'll be back with you again live on Friday night for game two of the two-game series between the NHL All-Stars and the Soviet All-Stars. And our John Saunders will also be dropping by with between-periods features on the big gala variety show and fashion shows and all the other doings that are all a part of the Quebec Winter Carnival and all a part of Rendezvous 87 in Quebec City. But don't forget, hockey fans, game two of our series, 7:30 Friday night, February 13th. Now let's go back upstairs to our broadcast location where Ken Wilson and Bill Clement are getting set for an exciting third period of play. Gentlemen?
Well, Tom Mies, you know, we knew that the Soviets were explosive offensively. We knew, and Bill mentioned it more than once, that the NHL had some real snipers. So we knew there'd be a lot of offense, or at least we thought there would be. But Bill, it seems after two periods, we have a tight checking, low scoring game.
And I think, Ken, that that's what the National Hockey League team wanted to do from the start. We talked about tempo. And if the Soviets are allowed to establish that very, very high tempo, their skills are able to be accentuated. When you look at the number of turnovers, the NHL team committed 47 turnovers. The Soviet team, 54 turnovers. We're talking about 100 turnovers in a couple of periods of hockey. That means to me that it's a very, very tight, close-checking first two periods, and that's what the doctor ordered for the National Hockey League team. The Soviets would like to open it up. There's no question.
2-1, the NHL leads the Soviets. It's been a tremendous week. Alan Thicke was great as a host last night at the Grand Theater. He's with John Saunders.
Bill, standing here with the star of ABC's Growing Pains, Alan Thicke, and I know you're a good friend of Wayne Gretzky's, so they can't seem to keep him down. Doesn't matter who he's playing against.
He's as good as there ever was, and he's playing very well tonight. He's got to be the MVP tonight. Our guys play with a little more emotion and go in spurts, so I hope they can spurt more than the other guys stream.
And hope we can do it for two games.
Yes, the other guys are pretty consistent.
Okay, thank you very much. Let's go back to the booth and Ken and Bill.
Well, we're talking hockey, and that's what Bill and I are paid to do, and we enjoy it every minute, but it's been a tremendous week. Other things, culture and art also. So let's take a look right from culture and art to the scoring summary. Bill, you did a good job talking about that. There's the second period summary. Glenn Anderson gets the goal at 17 minutes, the assist to Mario Lemieux. Then the Soviet Union comes back with their only goal of the night, Alexei Kostatonov, the veteran playmaking defenseman, and the assist goes to Sergei Makarov. There are the shots on goal, the NHL with the margin there.
Ken, Kostatonov is a very, very good two-way defenseman, and he is kind of shadowed by number two, Vyacheslav Fetisov, his partner. Interesting to note that when Fetisov is injured or for some reason is not in uniform and Kostatonov is not paired with him, he becomes a far greater offensive threat. He wheeled in that time and got a, how shall we say, a lucky one on Grant Fuhr, because Grant Fuhr is not really, tonight at least, he's been very, very steady. That indecision cost him, but Kostatonov in his own right, we talked about him at the top of the show as being one of the two top defensemen in the Soviet Union.
Well, I alluded to the fact, as Tom and John have, that there's been a lot of culture and art here. We alluded to the concert last night. Crystal Gayle, Gordon Lightfoot, Paul Anka, Bolshoi Ballet Stars, the Red Army Choir, and I don't even think those were the headliners.
I was too busy climbing stairs, I think. I'm still climbing stairs today.
It's been a lot of fun this week in Quebec, and we're thrilled to have you here with us for Rendezvous 87 on ESPN. Ken Wilson, Bill Clement, a cast of thousands, the Soviet national team, Larionov to Makarov, his shot! Fuhr makes the save with Krutov buzzing in on the right wing. There comes the NHL back. Dineen has stopped. Krutov turns the puck to the middle green. Ahead out of the reach of Poulin. Half a minute gone in the third period. NHL making a player change. They lead it 2-1. Now the Soviets take over Sergei Makarov. He plays on the big line with Larionov and Krutov. This is the defenseman Fetisov. Oh, is he upended by Ramsey? Larionov to Krutov off the back of his skate. And the NHL clears the puck to center ice. Be interesting to see how the Soviet goes here in the early going. The Soviet Union would like, I'm sure, to establish themselves here in the first 5 minutes of period three, trailing by a goal. Soviets really closing up the middle on the NHL. Samuelson knocks down Zvetlov, and the puck held for a faceoff deep in the NHL All-Stars end.
And we had talked earlier about us discussing the selections. As everybody plays armchair quarterback, I guess, they sit at home and they say, gee, how did this guy make the team? And perhaps we should have had this man on the team. I don't think anyone argued when number 9, Glenn Anderson of the Edmonton Oilers, was selected. He has played international play with the Canadian Olympic team before he turned pro. Watch Kevin Dineen swoop in here on Belosheikin. Cut the corner a little sharp on Evgeny Belosheikin.
Puck comes to center ice. Sweeping through is Muller. He's got Messier, but he's having trouble getting around to Taranov. And Bork fans, he's tied up. Messier swooping in. He's got Muller behind the net. And a nice check by Taranov. Delio's tied up. Anderson keeps the puck in. Glenn Anderson breaks for the net. Muller a shot and making the save and freezing it is Evgeny Belosheikin. This is Rendezvous 87 on ESPN.
The Soviet team certainly is capable of playing strong defense. Muller swoops to shoot. One red, number 30, riding out a National Hockey League player, and then the other side, the defenseman helping out. They kept the lane so clear in front of Belosheikin that it was actually an easy save. They can play some very, very solid defense.
Curry and Anderson of the Edmonton Oilers have scored for the NHL. Veteran defenseman Alexei Kostatonov on a weak shot from the slot that seemed to handcuff Grant Fuhr has scored for the Soviet national team. Faceoff deep in the Soviet zone. With the puck, Wayne Gretzky. Pre-planned play to Tikkanen, and he centers for Curry, and Jari Kurri is too well covered. On the attack, the Soviet Union with the puck, trying to center it. Omyatov, and that play broken up. 2 minutes have gone by in the third period here in Quebec City. Bikoff, a drive, and he scores! The Soviet Union ties it. Vyacheslav Bikoff beats Grant Fuhr low, and it is 2-2.
You can never have too many goals against the Soviet Union. They are so explosive, and we talked about protecting the blue line. The National Hockey League team did not protect the blue line on this one. Let Bikoff come right over, swoop from his right to his left. He gets very, very good wood on it as well. From off one post into the net and out the other post. It went post, center of the net, and out. They gave away the blue line on that one.
It takes the Soviets only 2 minutes, 3 seconds to score in the third period. That would seemingly be a huge goal for the Soviet national team. And one of the points the NHL All-Stars are aware of, the Soviets quickly and frequently score goals in a row. One goal, then in 30 seconds another, and then quickly another goal. Curry upended. This crowd, partisan to the NHL, wanted a penalty. They don't get it. Samak for the Soviet Union to Priyakin. Priyakin behind the net, taken out by Green. Here's Gretzky. The NHL in this period here trying to prevent a letdown, trying to stave off the Soviet Union. The Soviets for that one goal and nothing more. Krutov, one of the greats in Soviet hockey. Vladimir Krutov, number 9. Both teams are changing on the fly. It's 2-2. Sergei Markov. Makarov trying to get the puck in front, and he can't. He can't beat Mike Ramsey. To Claude Lemieux. Claude Lemieux clears the zone. Kasatonov gets the puck to Krutov for the Soviets. Back to Kasatonov. Makarov. He's on with Larionov and Krutov. Makarov losing the puck to Alf Samuelsson, the star defenseman out of Sweden and from the Hartford Whalers. A pass for Mario Lemieux from Goulet stop. Makarov. Krutov. He lets it go, and Fuhr closes the pads, and before Larionov can get the puck, the NHL clears to center ice. Krutov again. He's stopped. And it's Samuelsson, 2:03, the time of the Soviets' goal. Bikoff from Starikov and Homotov. It is 2-2, 4 minutes gone, third period. Mario Lemieux stop, nice poke check on the play, but it is offside. NHL, great game, 2-2.
Ken and Bill, I don't believe they play a lot of hockey in Brazil, but Pelé has still joined us here. Did you become a hockey fan when you were living in New York?
Oh, yes, no doubt. I think hockey is a very similar of soccer, the same pattern of the game, you know? You attack, defend, you have to be smart to dribbling. I love the game.
Okay, thank you very much. All the greatest are here from all the worlds of sports. Back to you, Ken and Bill.
Thank you, John Saunders. Of course, in the Soviet Union, Bill, the two most popular sports, ice hockey and soccer.
There is the Soviet captain. We got a glimpse of him. Vyacheslav Fetisov seems to have injured his left knee, perhaps getting ice on it. He would be a big loss for this Soviet team.
Now the NHL All-Stars, Muller to Messier, and the puck hops over his stick. Anderson digs after it. He's beaten to it. Larionov gets the puck out. Now it's Doug Wilson for the NHL. He's teamed with Ray Bourque. Bourque of Boston's Bruins, Wilson from the Chicago Blackhawks. Muller with Anderson and Messier dumping it in. Messier is beaten to it. Verbukhin playing the puck around the boards, and the Soviets move to center ice, and quickly a chance for Semenov getting the puck in front, and Barnikov unable to get a stick on it. Quick shot, and a good save by Fuhr on Tatarinov. Messier for the NHL All-Stars, shooting the puck in. 2-2 the score, 5:10 gone in the third period. Green, his pass behind Gretzky. An icing coming up as Igor Stelnov touches the puck for the Soviet Union, and the faceoff will come back near Grant Fuhr.
There's the wife of the Canadian Prime Minister, Brian Mulroney, Mrs. Mulroney in attendance, and she hosted a very nice fashion show luncheon this morning that our wives attended. Just one of the many functions, and accompanied as usual by Brian Mulroney, the Prime Minister of Canada. He is describing now what happens on a face-off. He's setting up the face-off for her.
Well, you be careful, because if he comes up here to be the analyst, you'll be down there running the country.
I have enough to do right here, thank you.
NHL controls in their own end. Green, the Montreal Canadiens defenseman, gets it out, and quickly Bykov, the goal scorer, with a puck and yanked down by Messier. Here's Langway. Green. Jari Kurri. On with Gretzky and Tikkanen. Tikkanen from Langway, firing the puck in around the boards, and Belosheikin stops it as Gretzky was lurking. NHL begins to change players as Kamensky is stopped. Moving up on the play, Bykov. And his pass fails to reach Stelnov. This is Kurri, the Finn. Gretzky, the great one. Jari Kurri, another Finn. And Samuelson is Popchek, two-on-one break. Kamensky, he shoots, and Fuhr gets a piece of that slap shot from Valerie Kamensky. Wayne Gretzky for the NHL All-Stars. There's 13:42 to go in the third period. It's 2-2. These two teams playing tonight by NHL rules. Should it be tied after regulation play, there'll be a five-minute overtime period. Fuhr leaving the puck for Samuelson. Kept in by Belly Letinov. And then the NHL All-Stars led by Samuelson to Howard Chuck. Dineen breaks for the net. The pass to Dineen, and he gets the puck lost in his skates. And the save by Belosheikin. At the Coliseum in Quebec, it's 2-2.
Here's our reverse angle with Dale Howard Chuck of the Winnipeg Jets doing his version of the reverse angle. He stops, throws the Soviets out of position, and Kevin Dineen is in a little too tight. That pass jams into Belosheikin's there to make the save anyway.
Back to live action. Howard Chuck for the NHL. In front is Dineen. He shoots and scores. Set up by Poulin. Howard Chuck and Poulin set up Dineen. The NHL leads it 3-2.
Was jammed on that first chance, Ken, a minute ago, but he wasn't jammed on that one. Dave Poulin passes this right onto Kevin Dineen's tape. Howard Chuck along the boards, back into the corner to Poulin, and Dineen is jockeying for a position out front. He actually is loose. Larionov is a centerman, number 11. He is sagging back in. Watch him try and get to Dineen a second too late. He had to move back in because number 2, Fetisov, had actually pinched to the corner to try and get Poulin. You have to fill that zone area when it is vacated. Larionov didn't cover in time for Fetisov. Dineen was right there to jam that one home. He made no mistake about it.
7:03 of the third period, the time of the tie-breaking goal. Dineen from Howard Chuck and Poulin, and the NHL All-Stars have the lead again. The NHL has never trailed tonight. It's 3-2. Here comes Poulin, his shot. And it's off the stick of Kasatonov and into the crowd. So Bykov scores for the USSR at 2:03 to tie it. And then the Dineen goal at 7:03 to give the NHL the lead again.
The two grinders for this NHL team, Kevin Dineen of the Hartford Whalers and Dave Poulin of the Philadelphia Flyers, figuring on that goal. Two excellent, excellent all-around hockey players. I don't think they were much of a surprise, Ken, either. Some people may have raised their eyebrows a little bit, but people that follow hockey, as we look at it again, boy, Dineen just jammed it right up past Belosheikin. People that follow hockey really know the merits of someone like Kevin Dineen, someone like Dave Poulin. Poulin especially, not very flashy player, just excellent both ways.
Here come the Soviets on the attack. Letlov loses the puck. It's kept in by Perbukin. His shot blocked by Muller, but Perbukin ends up with the puck again. Leaves it for Varnikov, number 19. He loses it in turn to Bork. And it gets by to Taranov. Interestingly enough, two of the three NHL All-Stars goals have come directly from Soviet defensive zone turnovers. Moving right in and scoring is Semenov, Anatoly Semenov. Oh, you talk about explosive. The Soviets tie it at 3.
He may have paid the price, Ken. He is holding his midsection, and he may have actually speared himself or run into the tip of Grant Fuhr's stick, but what a move he made on Grant Fuhr, pulling it to his forehand. beat him very, very cleanly. He had at least 3 feet of the net to shoot in. Gets in behind the Soviets. You never know when they're going to strike. He pulls it way to his forehand. Gee, it looked as if he was holding his midsection. We'll see if we can see from here. He obviously rams into the goalpost with his shoulder. What an excellent, excellent goal. Just a fine move to his forehand. Notice how he sets it up on his backhand and pulls it way over to his forehand. There's very little a goaltender can do when a forward is able to maneuver the puck that long a distance. That covered 6 feet from the time he took it on his backhand, slid it all the way over and brought it to his forehand. He must have covered 6 or 7 feet of ice, and it's so difficult to defend.
It is 3-3 here in game one of Rendezvous 87. Coming to you from the Coliseum in Quebec City. Game two, 7:30 Eastern, Friday night here on ESPN, and there'll be a penalty. A penalty coming up against the NHL's Esa Tikkanen.
Ken, we had talked before the game about slowing down the Soviets, hooking, holding, anything you can. Well, this time the NHL team didn't get away with it. Esa Tikkanen of the Edmonton Oilers actually trying to impede the progress of one of the Soviets, and he wasn't really very far away from referee Nikolai Morozov, who's called, by the way, a very, very excellent game tonight, I would say, Ken.
Look at that reaction from Esa Tikkanen, 2-minute penalty coming here in the third period. Well, Budweiser keeping this exciting action going at Rendezvous 87. Budweiser wants you to enjoy the game, and certainly now would be an excellent time to enjoy that tremendous flavor of Budweiser. For all you do, this Bud's for you. Semenov scoring at 8:04 for the Soviet Union. Barnikov gets one assist. Tatarinov gets the other. And it is 3-3. The NHL shorthanded. Kaminsky slap shot wide. At the right point, Starikov. Kaminsky again. He's got some skating room. Starinov. At the left point is Stelnov. This is Kaminsky, number 13. He's on with Homyatov and Bikov. Starinov. Kaminsky. In front, Bikov. Stelnov. Playing it around off the stick of Homyatov. And Wayne Gretzky ends up with a puck. Can't clear it. Bikov. Stelnov. Kaminsky. Cross-checked down by Rick Green. NHL playing shorthanded. 3-3 is the score in the third period here in Quebec City. Bikov has a goal. Looking for the give and go at the point. And a good save by Fuhr on Starinov. Kaminsky to Homyatov. In front is Bikov. Fuhr and Gretzky playing way in green, killing the penalty in front of Fuhr. Just over 10 minutes to go in the third period. A nice steal by Langway. And he clears the puck the length of the ice, and the NHL All-Stars will change players. The Soviets make some personnel changes of their own. 21 seconds to go in the Soviet power play. Igor Larionov stopped at the NHL blue line. This is Sergei Makarov. Slowed up by Poulin. And Larionov gets the puck. This is Fedosov. He is literally drilled to the ice by Samuelson. You saw Fedosov moments ago tending to his knee in the runway. And Vyacheslav Fedosov there getting many bones rattled.
One of the big losses, Ken, if they do lose Fedosov, he looks as if he's all right, is leadership. He is not only their best all-around defenseman, but he is also their definite leader. As we look at Grant Fuhr, we're going to try and pick up where he makes this save. It's up high to his blocker side, off the blocker, perhaps off the handle of the stick. Sharp.
For the Soviets, their power play is over. They have had 4 power plays. They've come up empty, and they've had only 2 shots on goal on their power play. But look out. Krutov! Nice shot partially blocked by Samuelson. Krutov gets the puck again. He centers just out of the reach of the charging defenseman, Alexei Kasatonov. Here's Vyacheslav Fedosov. Nice pass to Igor Larionov. His feed out of the reach of Makarov, and the puck cleared to center ice. It's 3-3. Down to 9:10 to go in regulation play. Claude Lemieux for the NHL. broken up by Larionov. At center ice, Makarov with Krutov into the NHL defensive zone. Port yanks down the Soviet player Makarov. Goulet leaving the puck for Wilson. He's bothered by Krutov. Unable to keep the puck in at the point, Perbukin. Larionov turns it back. And Makarov in possession. The Soviets changing on the go. Kasatonov, the veteran. He has 27 points in 34 games against the NHL after a goal here tonight. Semitov, who was injured hitting the goalpost after scoring, back on. He's number 30. Doug Wilson whipping the puck around. Esa-Tikkanen on with Mario Lemieux and Claude Lemieux. Soviets shoot the puck back in. Perbukin. Fuhr leaves it. Doug Wilson has it. Up the middle. Out of the reach of Tikkanen. No icing. Vasily Perbukin getting the puck quickly to center ice. Semenov gives it off to Svetlov. Langway takes Svetlov out of the play. Now it's Barnikov centering. And Tikkanen intercepts for the NHL. And Tikkanen winding up in his own zone. Ed Manning to Gretzky. Little flip pass to Yari Kurri and a nifty poke check by Tatarinov. The Soviets grab the puck in their own zone. Svetlov just out of the reach of his teammate with a pass. And the NHL's Green gets the puck to center ice, intercepting Priyakin. He's number 22, taken out by Kurri, and here's Rick Green again. Down to 7:20 to go in the third period. It's 3-3, and there's non-stop action. The NHL All-Stars and the Soviet national team. Keeping it stopped, this is Gusarov quickly up on the wing. And the NHL taking over in their own zone, Samuelson. Now Ramsey. Samuelson again being pressured. And then the NHL getting stopped before they get to center ice. Yari Kurri with Gretzky. Kurri and the save by Belosheikin. Gusarov. His pass is errant. The puck the length of the ice. It'll be icing. Doug Wilson touches the puck, and there's a stop in play. 6:41 to go in the third. It's 3-3. Bill Clement, in the last few minutes here in this third period, you really feel the Soviet Union coming on.
Other than that one breakdown that Kevin Dineen scored on, Ken, the Soviet Union has slowly but surely taken it away from the NHL team. They've closed it down, down, down. The game seems to be shifting as we sit up here from our right to our left, closer and closer to Grant Fuhr all the time. I really think they're dominating more and more in the neutral zone.
3-3 is the score. The NHL has outshot the Soviet Union to this point, 25-21. 6:41 to go in regulation play. Back for the puck. Doug Wilson. Fuhr is way out of the goal. So Wilson has to cautiously handle the puck, and he clears it out of his own end. Back for it, Sergei Staranov, 28-year-old Soviet defenseman, hands it to Anderson in front. Messier fakes. Ooh, what a play by Belosheikin. An aggressive play by the young Soviet goaltender. Omatov getting the puck to Bykov, and Fuhr makes the save as Anderson had his man taken out. The NHL comes back. Ray Bourque trying to make something of a broken play, a little bit in the Soviet style, drills the puck in. Stelnov back for the USSR. Too far with his pass to Homyatov. Langway on defense with Green. Poulin breaks for the goal as Messier shoots the puck in. The NHL changing players. Poulin, who almost gets it in front to Anderson as he moved away from Fetisov. Here's Fetisov, the cagey veteran, to Makarov. He spun around. Look at Krutov slide in, but he can't control the puck. Rod Langway will go back for it. There's 5.5 minutes remaining in the third period. Outstanding opening game to Rendez-vous 87. Krutov stealing the puck away. On with Larionov and Makarov. Krutov. Kasatonov in front for Makarov, and he really doesn't get good wood on the puck in front of a sliding Grant Fuhr. Poulin trying to clear, unable to. Makarov for Krutov, and Green takes that pass. A feed to Howarchuk. He's slowed off by Fetisov. It's Krutoff for the USSR. Trying to move in around Ramsey. He's unable to. Dineen, a nice pass to Muller. Dineen, Howardchuk, and Muller. Muller leaving the puck deep in the Soviet zone. And Krutoff back for it. He has seen a lot of ice time here in the third period. Vladimir Krutoff. 4:38 to go in the third period. It is 3-3. Barnikov sends the puck up the middle as he takes a tough check. Svetlov looking for Semenov. Can't get the puck to him. Now here's Prabukin. Ooh, and Fuhr makes a save, and a sterling save on Vasily Prabukin. Back for the puck, the Soviets. That's an icing against the NHL All-Stars. 4:15 to go in game one. In the third period, it's 3-3.
And as the play comes more and more to the NHL end of the ice, Grant Fuhr is being called upon to make more and more saves. He was screened on that one by number three of the NHL team, Mike Ramsey, but picked it up at the last minute. Here's a save he made earlier, right at the corner of the net, is Sergei Makarov, and he has scored a number from that distance, I can guarantee you, along with Krutoff and Larionov. Very, very explosive line for the Soviet Union.
In this period, the NHL All-Stars have been outshot by the Soviets 11-4. It is 3-3. Doug Wilson gains possession, clears to center ice, Prabukin. And the Soviets start out from their own blue line. Bykov and Semenov have scored for the Soviets. Dineen for the NHL in the third period. So the NHL with the three goals, Curry, Anderson, and Dineen. The Soviets, Kasatonov, Bykov, and Semenov. And overtime certainly looming as a distinct possibility here at the Coliseum in Quebec City. Bort takes the puck. A crowd in front. Deaconen and Claude Lemieux. Prabukin playing the puck around the boards. Kept in by Langway. And Tatarinov makes no mistake about getting the puck out. And it's an icing call against the Soviets with 3:14 to go in regulation play.
Tatarinov icing the puck there, Ken. It's interesting to note that the Soviets are not afraid to go into a prevent type of defense as well, but the score is tied 3-3. I would have expected something a little more creative from Tatarinov, but Claude Lemieux was barreling in on him, and as it turned out, Tatarinov did pay the price. All 220 pounds of Lemieux leveled him.
Bill, we're late in the third period of game one of this two-game Rendezvous 87 series. My impression is that the two teams are very equal. They've both been able to prove that they can shut each other down. We've seen some tremendous individual performances, and both extremely well-skilled. In other words, it has been superb hockey.
It has been.
Langway for the NHL All-Stars. On with Green, Curry, Deakinen, and Gretzky. Soviets make it tough for the NHL All-Stars to get out of their own end. Gretzky's pass to Curry, broken up nicely. And the man who did it gets the puck. Now the NHL takes possession. Green over to Ramsey. He'll shoot it in. The Sabres veteran defenseman dumping it in. Gusarov. Homyatov. Up the middle for Semak. Now it's Gretzky. One on one. Around Gusarov. Gretzky shoots. Hits the side of the net. I'll tell you, you want to see a young defenseman scramble. That's what Alexei Gusarov did. And scrambled in a hurry. The play is offside. NHL All-Stars. There's 2:14 to go in regulation play, and it is 3-3.
You know, Ken, that is one of the first times in this game that the Soviets have allowed Wayne Gretzky to become isolated one-on-one in an offensive situation with one of their players. This time it's Gusarov. Gretzky basically blows around him. Good defensive play by number 14 of the Soviet Union coming back in to actually take away. Watch Gretzky. You'd think he might be able to cut to his right. But Wayne knows there's someone cutting from his right back in front of the net. Look how quickly the Soviets get back in there to close everything off, and he was really forced to shoot from a sharp angle.
I really like that point you made, Bill Clement, about Wayne Gretzky. In a typical NHL game that we would see here on ESPN, he'd have six, seven, eight opportunities by this time where he'd have the puck alone and be able to do things with it.
And he would have been allowed in the NHL, not intentionally, but his skills are so great that he controls the puck. We talked about this before the game. When you control the puck in the Soviet zone, you buy time, they break down. They have been wonderful at turning over the puck when the NHL has possession of it in their zone. They make that concerted effort, and we really haven't seen Wayne Gretzky hang on to it that long tonight in the Soviet zone.
One of the things we talked about early was the skill of the forwards. Two on ones, three on twos, and we've not seen that many of those three on ones, two on ones, three on twos tonight. Ooh, just getting the puck out is Ray Bourque. Claude Lemieux barrels through, barrels away with Mario Lemieux. Kaminsky does a nice job stopping Claude Lemieux. Here's Homyutov. Down to 1:42 to go in regulation play. The Soviets on the attack. Kaminsky can't get around Doug Wilson. There's a fine play. Then Mario Lemieux stopped by Bykov. It's Kaminsky for the Soviets. Leaving it at the defense. Fedosov in the middle to Makarov. It's 3-3 with 1:25 to go in the third period as Makarov falls down. Mario Lemieux with Dave Poulin. Mario Lemieux. He shoots. He scores. And Poulin may have deflected it. The NHL takes the lead with 1:15 to go in the third period. Mario Lemieux tonight. For Mario Lemieux has been reasonably invisible, but he's not invisible here. What a great angle to look at it from. Dave Poulin tipping it by Belosheikin. This is the control I was talking about, Ken. He's able to cut across the blue line, contain, maintain possession of the puck, then get wood on at the net. The Soviets have not allowed the NHL team to do that at all tonight. Finally, Mario Lemieux gets it in gear. Gets a pretty decent shot away, and Dave Poulin pops it right up over Belosheikin's right arm and into the net for a lead, and we might be able to avoid overtime.
Boy, what a pretty deflection by the Flyers captain. Oh, that's picture perfect.
Mentioned overtime. We will see overtime should this hockey game end tied. It is National Hockey League rules, and there will be a 5-minute overtime period if the score remains tied. At the end of 5 minutes, it remains tied.
18:45 of the third period. Poulin scores. NHL leads 4-3. Here's Krutov for the explosive Soviets. To Makarov off his skate. Dineen clears the puck out. Defense is the theme now for the NHL. The big guns, the KLM line on for the Soviets. Larionov, Makarov, Krutov. This is Makarov. To Larionov. He fakes Fedosov in front and unable to turn the puck in. Krutov. And there was the perfect example of the tremendous patient passing of the Soviet national team. Langway dumps the puck out. 35 seconds to go in the third period. Belosheikin still in the goal for the Soviets. They trail 4-3 as Fedosov shoots the puck in. Ray Bourque is back. Down to 26 seconds left. Third period of play in game one of Rendezvous 87. Back for the puck goes Alexei Kasatonov. And it's finally shoveled all over to Fedosov by Belosheikin. 14 seconds to go. And this crowd in an uproar in Quebec City. There are 8 seconds left. The NHL wins game one of Rendezvous 87. Quite a night. The Soviets do not pull their goalie. What an opportunity, NHL style, that would have been. Belosheikin stands and watches. The NHL wins it 4-3 on a goal at 18:45. They give it to Mario Lemieux, but it certainly looked like a Dave Poulin goal. At any rate, the NHL All-Stars win game one. It just sets the stage for Friday night.
Doesn't it, Ken? And to me, the Soviet team was gaining more and more control. We talked about it as the game went on. And you know what it boiled down to? The individual greatness of someone like Mario Lemieux being able to cross the blue line and stave off the Soviet defenders long enough to get a decent shot away that Dave Poulin deflected into the net. Here's Lemieux crossing the blue line, trying to buy time. Fedosov, number two, as good as he is defensively and offensively, was unable with that long reach that Lemieux has to make any headway in checking him. The goal was a result of Lemieux's individual greatness.
It was the first time we really saw Mario in the game.
Really, it was, and he saved it for a good time, didn't he, as far as the NHL team is concerned?
And interestingly enough, just after, Wayne Gretzky had his big opportunity of the night.
Belosheikin hanging from the net. He realizes it's interesting to know, too, that the Soviets never pulled Belosheikin. They had the puck right in behind Grant Fuhr with 40 seconds to go, did not make a move to pull Evgeny Belosheikin from their net.
It's not their want, usually. They've got the official scoring now down on the winning goal. Dave Pullen from Mario Lemieux and Doug Wilson at 18:45. And certainly a happy international crowd with some NHL partisans here in Quebec City tonight. That was, I thought, a wonderful hockey game. Enjoyment, closely played. Super start to Rendezvous 87. Game one, the final 4-3 NHL All-Stars over the Soviet national team. Don't go away. There's more to come from Quebec City on ESPN.
He was one of the ones that really wanted
to. At the Coliseum in Quebec City, the NHL All-Stars Player of the Game selected here tonight, Marc Messier, receiving a lovely picture from former Montreal star Guy Lafleur. So Marc Messier is selected by the folks here in Quebec City as the NHL All-Stars MVP tonight. The Soviet national team's MVP of this game, Sergei Markarov.
Nice choices, but you have to look to the players such as Dave Poulin and Kevin Dineen for this NHL victory tonight, besides Marc Messier, the lesser lights. It took great individual efforts on Wayne Gretzky's part, on Yari Curry's first period goal, Mario Lemieux's effort in this final goal, but it was a guy like Dave Poulin, the grinding type of player, along with Kevin Dineen, Ken, that I think really made a big difference in tonight's game.
There's more coming up from Rendezvous 87 in a moment. The Soviets tonight in Game 1 get goals from Kostatonov, Bykov, and Semenov. The NHL goals from Yari Curry, Glenn Anderson, Kevin Dineen, and Dave Poulin. And the winner from Dave Poulin. And Bill, in looking back now, I thought it was not only a well-played game, but rather evenly played.
I think it was evenly played. The Soviets, to me, started to really bring the play to the NHL All-Stars in the last half of the game. But it was easy for them to do it, Ken. I noticed that the NHL All-Stars defense continued to back in and back in and back off defensively. They didn't play as aggressive defensively. If I were the Soviet team, I would not do much different on Friday night. However, if I was the NHL All-Star team, I would have to seriously consider maintaining that strong defensive blue line posture throughout the 60 minutes. We saw what they could do once they gained possession of the offensive zone. The Makarov and Krutov and Larionov, they can undress you and leave you lying on the ice and pop the puck up into the top of the net so quickly.
And, you know, you go back to your checklist from before the game. Three key points as far as the Soviets were concerned. I most remember they had to shut down Gretzky and Mario Lemieux. They didn't do it at the very end, but overall they did.
Overall they did, but that is what happens when you have players with that greatness. Once in a while, they break open. When they do, bing, it's in the net.
Well, Grant Fuhr has greatness. I thought especially early in the second period, he was just tremendous in goal for the NHL All-Stars. And with Grant Fuhr, let's go to Tom Meese.
Okay, Ken Wilson, thank you very much. The last time I was with Grant Fuhr was at the All-Star game in Hartford last year. They were giving you a Jeep after that one. I don't know what the folks at Edmonton are going to give you this time, Grant. You had some spectacular saves tonight. Describe the feeling out there on the ice playing this excellent Soviet team.
I think the guys were really keyed up to play tonight. I mean, we went out, and the guys played with their hearts. They went out, they played a great game in front of me tonight.
Now, the Soviet team, they get down. They were down continually. 1-0, they were down 2-0, 2-1, 3-2. They never quit, and it must get a little bit scary sometimes seeing this red wave come at you time after time.
That's the way they play. They play in waves where at times they look like they're taking time off to rest, and other times they pour it on, but the guys kept checking them tonight, and we checked them for 60 minutes, and we got a win out of it.
A lot of people said, all right, we maybe think that the NHL has more talent collectively than the Soviet squad, but my goodness, how can they mount a competitive effort against such a great team like the Red Army team, basically, is what you faced, when you have you guys having basically one practice? How do you account for such a tremendous effort?
I think you guys played with a lot of heart tonight. I mean, heart can take up for a lot of things, and tonight, heart with a little bit of talent mixed in helped out.
You mentioned a little bit of talent. We have one of your saves on videotape against Fedosov. And I believe this is the one you come up big with your right glove hand. Let's take a look at it right down the slot. Well, no, this isn't that save, but you get your stick out and you stack the pads up a little bit there and keep the puck out to the left. You just seem to have the angles played very well tonight. Nothing really seemed to surprise you.
I got surprised, actually, on the second goal. You got away a little quicker than I thought he did.
Right.
But, overall, the guys blocked a lot of shots and made them shoot from the bad angles.
Okay, Grant Fuhr, one of the valuable members of Team NHL, victorious in game one of the series. Let's take one final look at what proved to be the winning goal tonight against the Soviets with a minute 15 to go. Watch the Flyers, Dave Poulin breaking down the slot. Mario Lemieux fires the puck, Poulin with a perfect deflection, and the Soviet goaltender is beaten. And look at the celebration by Kevin Dineen, by Dave Poulin, Mario Lemieux, and the sellout crowd here at Le Colisée in Quebec City. Our final score tonight in Game 1 of Rendezvous 87, the NHL All-Stars 4, the Soviet National Team 3. We'll be back Friday night, 7:30 Eastern Time, for everyone at Rendezvous 87. I'm Tom Mees. Good night, everyone.